Live from the Toad Hop Network studios
in Hollywood.
This
is the ToadHopNetwork.com.
A place of our own without a lot of parents peering down our backs.
Radio worth watching.
And here we go.
Hello, Schmoville. That's right. It's the Schmoes Know Movies podcast. I'm Christian Harloff.
And over here is Mark Ellis. Hello, Christian.
Hello, Marcus. Now, how great was that? We always get the music right beforehand, getting us ready. If you're listening to it live, you heard the music right beforehand.
Yeah, it ramps the kids up for what they're about to experience on the Schmoes Know Movies podcast, and that was a very apropos selection by you.
How great is it? If you're not familiar with what it was the Marx Brothers, the Lydia the Tattooed Lady song, which is from Breaking Bad. I won't say yet what part, because if you haven't seen that yet, you're not going to tune in from 9 to 10 when we do our full spoiler podcast on Breaking Bad from 9 to 10 p.m. tonight, Mark. Everything.
Yeah, we were thinking about doing like a two-hour show that's just Breaking Bad spoilers nonstop. And then we're like, well, we want everybody to enjoy it. So if you haven't seen Breaking Bad, the first hour of this show is for you. As always, we're joined by our lovely co-host, Tiffany Smith.
Who is a warrior, by the way. And I have a lot. Always had a lot of respect for you. I have so much more after the last couple of days.
What did you do today? Some jazzercising?
No, I texted her the other day and I said, listen, we're doing full Breaking Bad. Are you caught up? And she said, no. And this is like 2 days ago. She said no. And I go, are you going to be able to be caught up? She's like, probably not. This morning I get a text. I finished! !! So, Tiffany, way to go.
Well, way to go, Tiffany. Yeah. She's the one female in this room that has seen Breaking
only
Bad.
One.
Somebody who has not even seen one episode.
I didn't come here for this.
Of Breaking Bad.
I didn't come here for this.
We brought somebody who hasn't seen any of them. We're just going to spoil every secret in the show.
It's okay. I hadn't seen a single episode until RJ Mitty was coming on. Then I felt like I had to do it.
Right.
Held. Yeah.
And then she
I did that
it.
With Game of Thrones. I power watched 14 hours on a Kindle.
It's really fun. We
on
should
a
go
Kindle?
Ahead and.
Was,
we
yeah.
should probably use her now.
She's a longtime member of Schmoville. She's been with us for a very long time. We were on Current TV.
That's right. And then she went and got all big and famous. She won a season of Last Comic Standing. She hosts the dating show Excuse. And last night you saw her on the Arsenio Hall program.
Oh, yeah.
Murdering, doing stand up comedy. Her new hour, War Paint, just released on Netflix and on iTunes. She is the one, the only, our dear friend, Iliza Shelsinger, ladies
Thank
and gentlemen.
You.
Yeah, Iliza, finally gracing us with your presence. I love it. How are
not
you?
Not sure how I ended up here. I'm good. I think I wanted to go drinking with Mark, and he was going to
get roped in.
And then I'll drink after.
Yeah.
I'll do that.
And I
yeah.
said, look, Iliza, I'll practice your intro. That took me 3 months to get that all down.
That was one of the best intros ever.
I worked on it.
It comes from intimacy.
I really wanted the classic Arsenio, though.
Speaking of intimacy,
did they woof at the beginning of Arsenio?
Yeah, they do that.
I didn't see anyone do it, and I didn't want to do it because I don't, like, in case it was a thing that we weren't doing, I
don't
want to be. Like,
wouldn't they tell you
right?
that? Wouldn't they tell you in the green room? Don't woo woo.
They didn't say anything.
Okay.
The ads for the show are the old ones, so I feel like they want to have it be a throwback.
Wow.
You know?
Yeah, I didn't want to be. I just didn't want to be the one to broach that subject and then have him be like, you know, there's a reason I don't do that. I have tennis right. elbow. It's the reason I'm off the air.
Well, we're going to talk to Iliza more about Arsenio, and there's something I want to talk to her about because one of the things that during this weekend I tweeted this out. There's a big thing going on. It blew up over Twitter about Saturday Night Live, who they have been in.
It's a popular comedy program.
Yes, and in the past, they have been accused of stealing bits. They had been accused of stealing one from a great comedian, Jim Norton.
Mm-hmm. Another great comedian, Rick Shapiro, was confirmed to have a bit lifted while Jay Moore was
on
the show.
So it's happened, and then it seems as if it happened again this weekend with the lady sitting in the room with us. So
they took one of Tiffany's bits?
Yes. About Lord of
when
the Rings.
When I was doing my Gandalf impression.
Yeah, but we're going to talk to Iliza about that in a little bit, but we got to talk about the news, the movie news, what's going on. We'd like to get Eliza's take on some of the movie news, and then we'll talk to her about the Saturday Night Live fiasco. But first, our great Ken Knapsack doing the news. Johnny, I see you ready, my friend. Here we go.
I love that Ken's in a suit.
I'm Ken Knapsack, and these are your Schmoes Know headlines brought to you by Magic Hat Brewing Company. The first trailer for The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug, saw the light of day this week. The 2.5-minute clip shows that the movie appears to have a darker tone and clearly has enough Legolas in it to bring in the coveted, lonely women who were 20 when the Fellowship of the Rings came out demographic. It would be easy to make a joke about there not being a musical number in this trailer, but let's take the high road. Here are the other things we can celebrate. The brown wizard does not appear to be high on a synthetic form of marijuana called Stem of Gandalf. No swollen testicles are hanging from a troll king's face. And Benedict Cumberbatch is the voice of the dragon, meaning your girlfriend will now let you make dragon sex with her. The movie hits theaters December 13th. Fox has hired Simon Kinberg to rewrite their Fantastic Four reboot. This comes after four separate screenwriters have taken swipes at the script, only to have a studio executive say the third act needs more fantasticness. Kinberg will also produce. Chronicle's Josh Trank is still on board to direct. Kinberg, the writer of X-Men First Class and the upcoming X-Men Days of Future Past, is still working on a yet-to-be-revealed Star Wars standalone spinoff. And not one word of those scripts was written on a MacBook in a coffee shop. In more screenwriting news, all three of the credited writers for Amazing Spider-Man 2 are being brought back to write the third film in the rebooted franchise. The second film is still a year away from theaters, so no plot details have been released for the third film. But when reached for a comment, the three writers said the script will involve a guy in a costume who will have various obstacles placed in front of him as he tries to accomplish goals. But things will get really dark for him in the second act after the supervillain does something to the woman he loves, yet he will defeat him in a big final battle. Also, bad things happen to New York. Fade to black. Silver Linings Playbook and American Beauty producer Bruce Cohen is set to produce a film adaptation of the forthcoming Dark Horse graphic novel, The Fifth Beatle. The film will focus on the Beatles' manager, Brian Epstein, arguably the group's guiding light in the storm that was Beatlemania, who died of an overdose on a lonely weekend in 1967 while the Beatles took an audience with the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi. Production is set to start in 2014 for the kids at home. Graphic novels are the things your weird, still single uncle reads alone in his room on a Friday night while the smell of Del Taco just barely covers up the stench of failure. Universal Pictures announced that Ted 2 is a go, and Mark Wahlberg will be back for the sequel to the comedy that made $540 million worldwide in 2012, proving the world likes sexually active children's toys. McFarlane will once again be writing and directing, and the film is set for a, are you fucking kidding me, summer 2015 release. Meaning the only movie not set for the release that summer is the reboot of The Last Starfighter I wrote on my Commodore 64 in 1986. There's a lot of anticipation and award season buzz for the Naomi Watts film Diana, set to be released this November, but the advertising agency that handled the placement of the movie's posters had some splaining to do after one of the ads was placed near the entrance to the very tunnel Princess Diana died in during the tragically suspicious 1997 car crash. It was also directly across the street from the Flame of Liberty, a landmark that became an unofficial monument for the Princess of Wales. The agency quickly corrected the offending mistake, though to be fair, it was one of thousands of posters placed across the land, and it certainly was not done intentionally. However, there hasn't been an advertising mistake this offensive since a New Jersey business owner opened Das Hindenburgs near a landing site in New Jersey. Close to the Hindenburg, no. And finally, we at Schmoes Know Movies would like to take the time to pay our respects to author Tom Clancy, who passed away this week of an undisclosed cause. Clancy was a master of the military espionage spy novel, and his books, based around the character Jack Ryan, were turned into several movies, such as The Hunt for Red October, Patriot Games, and Clear and Present Danger. He was 66 years old. I'm Ken Napsack. Those were your Schmoes Know Headlines, brought to you by Magic Hat Brewing Company. For more news, be sure to tune to SchmoesKnow.com.
Wow. I mean, that Tom Clancy news is... Ken, how did he die? I'm sorry?
It's undisclosed.
It's undisclosed. Okay. Exactly.
That means he died having gay sex.
No, you stop undisclosed. That.
Hotel dead. Room, autoerotic dead. Asphyxiation.
He's a spy and an espionage.
That's true. It's true. You know, like that story alone, when I heard it, it was because the Jack Ryan trailer came out today as well.
Yeah, I didn't get a chance to see the Jack Ryan trailer yet. It was only on Yahoo for a minute, and I kept clicking Yahoo, and it wouldn't load on my computer. Oh, so maybe it's my computer. Maybe it's Yahoo.
Are you, Eliza, you a fan of these?
Did you say Yahoo? No,
yeah, he said Yahoo.
Yeah.
Were
you fan of the Clear and Present Danger movies and the Jack Ryan type things? Nah.
All of them, yeah.
Yeah, you liar.
All of all the military espionage.
If they don't have creepy Korean ghosts in them, you don't like them, right?
That's right.
All right.
Eliza's a big horror movie buff, but I was talking her into to maybe seeing Gravity this weekend, because it's like a white knuckle kind of thriller in outer space, right?
Yeah, we're gonna talk about Gravity a little bit in the second half an hour here, because that movie, oh, it's so good, so good. All right,
The Diana story is interesting to me, too. Eliza, how far did you get in the audition process to play
for
the Princess
movie?
Of Wales? Yeah.
Oh, it wasn't to play the Princess of Wales. It was to be the driver of the cab. There's no lines. And considering I've never been cast in anything, I don't know. I don't know how far I got.
You were pretty close on that on Funny People, right? Didn't you almost get cast in the Funny People role?
I couldn't say if I almost got cast, but I always get very close.
Yeah.
And then it's always like, we decided to go with a black man. And I was like, okay, so never. I was never close. It was never a thing.
They went with Brandon Johnson, who we had on the show last week, and he probably got cut out of the movie.
It's true.
Yeah. I've had that. I actually auditioned for a movie coming out. I think it's called Finally Famous. I think Chris Rock's in it. And I auditioned for the part of two black prostitutes, and they wanted one white girl to read both as one. So
wait, what?
That was the note. It was two black prostitutes. They're like, read all the lines as one person and be white.
Wow.
So I did it. And then they're like, can you just make it more real? And I was like, this is two black prostitutes that I'm reading. And you don't want this to be funny. You want it to be real. But I have to, like, it was just so, like,
you can handle.
Are you supposed to be like multiple personality prostitutes?
It was just, they wanted it. They wrote it for two and they wanted one person.
I'm picturing two casting guys just tired and going, let's just fuck with the next girl.
Yeah. Oh, whatever.
Just have a read. I don't know. You want to have a read as an Asian guy? Nah, two black girls.
Yeah. It's not a black chick. It's a white chick. Just read it.
I did like the best hustle and flow impression I could.
Can you give us a little impression of what you did?
I was like, you better have my motherfucking money, motherfucker. This ain't no fucking game. What you think this is? Storage Wars? I want my fucking money. Like, it's the best I could do. And they were like, just a little bit more real. Rein it in.
I feel like that woman knows where Tom Clancy is. Okay, so how about Spider-Man? The Spider-Man news is coming out. I know that JTI's head is spinning as we talk about Spider-Man. He doesn't.
Was not a big fan of The Amazing Spider-Man.
But we have the writers coming back for the third movie. Do you think they're jumping the gun here? Because I have to be honest with you. I don't think the second trailer looked good. I just didn't think it looked. I'm not excited about it. It could be okay.
You may not be excited about it, Christian Harloff, but there's a lot of people jacked to see that movie back with Jamie Foxx as Electro. I think that's going to bring in so much money that it doesn't matter if the movie's good or not. When you have a great villain like Electro, I think is going to be, then it's going to warrant a third film.
There's a dude named Electro.
Electro.
Electro. Yeah. So you all know who Electra is.
Oh, at the end.
Electra was another film.
Yeah, it was another one.
Another character from history.
I kind of feel like with those movies, though, if you're worried that it's not going to be great, it's good to have the other one already in the works because you're a little bit more forgiving.
Right.
Like, if I go in and I'm like, two is okay, but there's another chance with three, I already know they're working on it.
Three's your cap. Three's your cap. Yeah. If two sucks and three is just, you're
and
done.
Three is worse, then you're like,
The rule is after you spend $250 million making three of them, then
you
done.
Pull out. Right. Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
What do you got, brother? Stick your face in her.
I just don't like the writers that they hired for these. I don't.
What's your beef with them, Riley?
Okay. Orky and Kurtzman have been writing Transformers: Revenge of the Fallen. Then they wrote.
Didn't you write Star Trek?
Yeah, he did.
They
Star
wrote
Trek.
Star Trek. Yeah. I like it. I like that. But I want fresh blood. They've been doing like every blockbuster there is, and I just want someone different.
Listen, I get that, but you know how this game works as much as anybody, dude. Like, they stick with who's popular right now. That's what they do.
Speaking of who's popular, this Riley over there in the corner just got a huge head ever since we give him one review.
Yeah, he did.
Where he takes my place in the Gravity review, and all of a sudden he's walking around like, "Hey, I'm Mark Riley, the other schmo."
Sit here. Right?
No,
I have to sit here. Right?
Go away. Enough mic time for you. Go away.
Oh my god,
you did good.
You know.
I still put him in his place.
You give a homeless man one thing to eat, and then they just keep on. And
if you give a mouse a cookie,
that's
we all read the book.
And I gave the mouse named Eliza a cookie. When what was the first horror film you reviewed with? With us.
Oh, man. Eliza was the first person to replace me. I know Tiffany's done it since, but Eliza has filled in a couple times for horror.
I did feel kind of bad for you when those comments came out, too, because it's like, who's else with this hot chick? Yeah, and it's like,
that's the hottest.
Christian. What always happens, though, when any girl goes in with you.
It's true.
I could be a water buffalo with a bow on my head. Like, who's this hot chick? Mark, are you banging her?
That's yes.
Nobody cares.
I get it quite often from certain things. I have to ask you now that you're in chair. Eliza, you and Mark have never dated, correct?
We've never dated.
We've got that quite often.
That was an awkward pause.
We're not dating? Oh yeah, it was a pause.
I was trying to think of something funny is what that was.
This whole thing has been a charade.
We've gone out.
Okay. Oh.
Well, no. Right. We go out to dinner a lot. Oh. Mark Ellis and I have never dated.
Okay.
Never kissed.
Never.
Sometimes we eat in. Sometimes we go out.
I like the switch of the words.
We have couples fights. I made him try Thai food recently.
But that's where it goes.
I'm grooming him for the hot chick that's going to take my place soon and date him.
All right. All right.
Getting him ready.
So there you go, Schmobo. So stop tweeting in about that question.
Stop fucking around.
Why is this my Mick?
Okay, so there you have it. And then how are we feeling? Because we all like the comedies in the room. Eliza, how did you feel about the first Ted, and how do you feel about the news of a second Ted?
I like Ted. I like Mila Kunis, too. I thought she was great in it, and I thought it was great. I think Seth...
What is this? McFarlane.
Jesus Christ. I'm sorry. Why am I so tired? I slept a lot today. Between off a day job. Seth MacFarlane, I think he's so clever and funny and witty, and I love Mark Wahlberg. I love Mark Wahlberg if he doesn't talk. I love Mark Wahlberg on me. All the time.
At a Thai food.
Yeah, so I'm just going to watch that movie on silent. at home.
Well, you know, it's funny because you bring up Seth MacFarlane. I love the first Ted, and I'm so excited to see a sequel to Ted. And I don't think that Seth MacFarlane has anything to necessarily do with this, but one of my favorite shows of all time is The Family Guy.
Great.
And occasionally The Family Guy, you see something on The Family Guy that you're like, I've heard that in a club before. I've had some friends you see something similar and you're like, wait a minute, did one of their writers, because I know a couple of the writers, and they kind of sometimes they're just around clubs. I'm not saying they're doing anything on purpose. Right. Sometimes it's just like, hey, somebody had a similar take on a bit.
Parallel development.
But you can't help but notice it. Mm-hmm. And I think that something like that definitely went down with you on Saturday Night Live this past weekend, because I was at the Comedy Store in La Jolla and just in between shows, and I went to check my Twitter feed
and blew up.
Everything was blown up about how SNL lifted a bit.
Only because I was retweeting all of them.
But that's okay, though, because that brings me to this, though, too. And do you feel that they ripped off your bit?
Genuinely, when it first happened, I was on stage doing the job of a stand-up comic. And I got off stage and there was all these tweets. And so I started retweeting because I was like, well, may as well start a shitstorm and then figure it out after. Yeah, right. Always retweet shoot first, and then aim. So in my heart of hearts, I was like, all right, I haven't seen it. And the next day I watched it. Here's my thing. So I have this whole bit about boarding zones. The idea that like being stuck in boarding, for those of you that aren't familiar
with War Paint, available now on iTunes and Netflix.
Streaming on Netflix.
Me and Eliza are not dating.
Someone's going to edit that part out.
Yeah, yeah.
They're going to cut out the not part and it's just going to be choppy.
Yeah. Me and Eliza are dating.
Fucking. Oh, sorry.
It's about boarding zones, and it's about how it sucks to be stuck in boarding zone 4 and how they board everyone in the world before you, even though you have a ticket. And SNL did a sketch about this. Now, there's two sides of this argument. One, there's always the argument for parallel development. However, SNL, as I was saying to you earlier, has been on the air for 38 years.
Yeah.
And they've done airline sketches before.
Right.
Why would it be just now, after a couple weeks after my hour special, that you would choose the specific topic of boarding zones?
Right.
And if I were going to steal someone's bit, I would do what they did. I would steal the premise, gut the joke, fill it in with my own punchlines as they did.
Right.
Keep the premise. It's just a little weird because it's such a well that so many people have gone to, which I understand everyone talks about airlines.
But no, your point is valid. And the fact that it just...
Just now.
So the question, I guess, would be, do you think maybe, let's say on the side of that they did do this, do you think that it's maybe that, yes, you definitely have a following, but there's different levels. And maybe they feel that they can get away with picking on you.
Anybody, it's a bigger big fish, little fish thing. Here's the truth. At the end of the day, I'm not even bothered by it because there's no recourse either way. They're never going to apologize for... No one ever is going to apologize for
unless
material.
You're Jay Moore. Jay Moore admitted it after he got called
out.
He's
also a comic. I don't know much about that, but that's a little different versus hiding behind an entity that is a major
there's
show.
No one face.
And there's nothing... What I take from it is I was so touched that fans would reach out and defend me and be on my side.
Right.
So that's really what I gleaned from it. I was like, that's cool that I put this out. Plus, I've been doing the boarding zone bit for years.
Right.
So at the end of the day, at least no one's ever going to call me a thief.
That's true. And did anyone contact you afterwards at all? Did you hear anything from your representation or anything?
No, they don't know. But Entertainment Weekly did contact me. And I didn't want to. I don't think the way to get famous or attention is by causing trouble.
Right.
Like if I wanted that, then I would just walk around naked and make out with celebrities and flash my vagina and like whatever. Not you. I'm not going to just do that.
Sorry.
So I didn't really say much. And then this tweet came out about another show that was doing a boarding zone bit.
Oh, wow. So same type of joke?
It was about boarding zones. I didn't see it.
Okay.
So I just wrote her back and I was like, imitation is the most sincerest form of flattery.
Right.
And I just tried to be cool about it.
Right.
No one wants to take on NBC or Comedy Central or any of these shows.
Yeah.
I don't want to accuse anyone, especially if they didn't do it. It's just a little weird.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing, too. It's like, again, there's this giant shield called Saturday Night Live. So Saturday Night Live, the entity that Lorne Michaels created, did not necessarily steal a bit. But there could be a writer in there who's just like what happened with Jay Moore? Because Jay Moore turned in a sketch that he took a bit from Rick Shapiro, who was a contemporary comic, really funny guy.
Yep.
And Jay took it because he was a writer just struggling to tread water at SNL.
Right.
And it's like, you have a deadline. You need to hand in X amount of sketches.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And Jay didn't have shit that week. So he's like, I just got to throw this in there. He never thought in a million years that they would pick it because they hadn't picked any of his stuff. And then they pick it and he finds out it's going to be on the air. And he's like, oh, shit.
You know what?
You know,
you apologize. Nothing's going to happen to anyone. There are plenty of comics who make careers out of stealing. Nothing happens to them.
Right.
And the truth is this, at the end of the day, if there were intellectual property rights laws, if there were intellectual property laws, none of us would be able to talk about anything.
That's true. No, and
because we've all talked about
it. I think what it comes down to is the fact, what you said before, Eliza, and that's the fact that people... they have a great respect for you, that they were retweeting it and getting behind you, and the fact that now what you can do also is that it, regardless, you got a lot of press from it. You know, you
I got a little press, and I've made a career out of being an underdog, and I think people like to kind of defend their underdog. Yeah. Also, best be sure, I got the names of those writers.
Oh, you did?
Oh, yeah. I tweeted my friend that lives at, I texted her that writes at SNL, and I was like, who are the two writers?
Did you tweet them?
No, but I know their names.
Nice.
So don't fucking pull that again.
Yeah.
I love it. Okay.
I'd also like to say to everybody at SNL, any of my material is available for use.
Get to the castle.
Get to the castle.
Get right to the castle.
I'd love to see Entertainment Weekly call me and be like, well, you can tune into the Schmoes No podcast on Thursday when we talk about that very
There's a Batman on a treadmill on Saturday. All right, Tiffany, you got something to say?
I mean, for people who, I'm not a comedian. I've never worked in this world. How did, like, could someone come up to you and be like, hey, I loved this bit. Can we use it on SNL? Like,
they
how does it work?
They could,
but
I wouldn't.
They have to pay you.
I don't know what it would be priced at, but there's also, I mean, there's almost a respect thing there. If someone did that, then I could be like, I don't really know. I don't think it works that way because no writer would want to admit that they couldn't come up with something.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's so much comedy in the world. If you can't come up with original bits, like, what are you doing writing?
And that's
so
exactly what they're going to do is that they're going to say exactly what we've been saying here, and that's, oh, it just by circumstance. We happen to come up with the same type of
bit. Yeah, but at least Eliza's got a bit that's on war paint, and it's already been, it was available before SNL, that SNL sketch came out.
I time-stamped it.
Well, what we need to do is do what they did for the Carlos Mencia and Bill Cosby bit when they did the side to side.
Yeah.
We need to make a side by side video.
Unfortunately, their bit is nothing, like the premise is there,
but the jokes are different.
It's way different. I mean, mine's just speaking and theirs is more visual because it's a sketch.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's nothing to be done. I'm not angry about it. And I was touched by the fans.
As you should be. Okay. So, guys, if you, again, check out the bit in question and also check out the whole special War Paint on Netflix. And that's Eliza at Eliza.
Yeah. How the hell do you get that Twitter hit? It's just at
Iliza. That's it.
No one spells their name in an annoying way. No one spells Eliza that way. And it's worked against my whole life. And it only worked out for me on Twitter.
Yeah.
Because no one else has it.
Well, you'd be screwed if someone else had that. Because if they're trying to spell Schlesinger, that's not the easiest.
No, please don't remind me.
There. It's like spelling
Schmoes. Phantom C. Yeah.
Yeah.
Eliza Schmoesinger.
Yeah.
That's our name.
We get married.
We get married. That's it.
Aww, so sweet. I like what's going down here with the iced tea and everything. You
should
take a sip of your iced tea when you get married.
See me on Monday when we have to go eat Thai food.
You should just put two straws in there and shit.
I know.
Mark really put in effort for the Thai food.
I don't
want to
eat Thai food.
And you loved it, didn't you?
You know, it's always for women. He had sushi for a girl, and now he had Thai for a girl.
I explained to him. I got in the car. I was like, let me pitch this to you. You have to eat this with me now so that when a hot girl wants to go out with you, your palate will be ready, prepped and ready for the Eastern experience.
Turn into like a sweaty mess.
Thing, you know when a hot girl is actually going to go out with me? The summer of 2015. There's going to be a movie on it.
Very nice. What's the next movie? What do you got? What's everything's coming out. And that's when Bears comes out too,
Desolation
right?
of Sam. No? I want to talk about the Desolation
2014,
of
2014, sorry. Bears absolutely. Nice. We should absolutely talk about that. Eliza, are you a Lord of the Rings Hobbit fan?
Every topic you've broached, I haven't been
able
to chime in on unless it's been about me. Well, no.
What's your I know you like horror films. Is that your only genre? In comedies, right?
Yeah.
Oh, you talked about Ted. You liked Ted.
You like pretty guys. How about Orlando Bloom?
I'm not into him.
He's kind of wussy, right? He's kind of a puss.
He's kind of a delicate, pretty.
You like the tough guys.
He's the hottest that he's ever only been in as like this.
Drag your knuckles, grow some hair on your neck, call me in the morning.
Yeah. I'm not going home with an elf.
No.
Come on.
Hey, Eliza, let's go out. Good.
Perfect.
All right, you got it. Perfect.
Thor, thank you. Craig, is that your name? I'll go.
I'm going to hit you with a piece of meat.
The trailer for The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug came out, and Tiffany, you were wowed by it.
I think that I'm along the lines with a lot of people where the trailer had a lot of stuff in it that's not in the book.
Mm-hmm.
And so I do not want to watch the trailers anymore.
See,
I just want to like check out and then go see the movie. Yeah, I'm like a huge
Show her the tattoo.
Fan.
Yeah, she's got an elvish tattoo.
Oh my god.
It's
they have this in the Sky Mall catalog too, but it's a semi-permanent
it's like
tattoo.
Water.
In elvish that tattoo means boarding zone 4.
Oh
it's
my god.
Weird.
That's
had
your
that,
boarding pass.
I wrote that.
I stole it from you
and I turned it into elvish.
Hilarious.
Tiff, don't you think though for these movies like with The Hobbit, because they split it into three movies now.
Yeah.
Now I think that everyone, I think everyone needs to realize that this movie, it's not going to be based off the books, and it's a completely. This is more of a prequel to Lord of the Rings.
I'm not upset. that they added in more stuff, but like we talked about this summer where I was like, why do I have to see 16 trailers for a movie that I'm going to go see when I've already seen half of it? So I'm like, for this film, I saw the first trailer. I'm going to go see it.
Right.
Nothing in the trailer is going to make me not see it.
They already got your money. It's not like it's this weird indie film called The Hobbit that nobody's heard of. Yeah. We all know what this is. Show us one trailer, tease the hell out of us, and then we'll go see the movie.
And I am excited to see Evangeline Lilly in it.
I can
love the completely blank look you just
I had to remember. I was like the girl from Lost. This is Kate from Lost. Yes, I'm in.
Mm-hmm. All right, Eliza, then let's go. Let's have a movie that you can talk about before you
just
take
over here
off.
Nose breathing.
Yeah. What out of the movies that are coming out in the next couple of months, is there anything particular that you're nothing at all? That you're a movie girl,
head,
though. You like movies?
I'd have to hear about there's a What's some movies on? I want to see now. You have to say it to me.
Well,
that
what
I'd
about
have to
Gravity?
Think.
I know that we're going to talk about it in a little bit, but real quick.
Yeah, I'd like to see it.
Because okay, it because
only because he told you.
Here's
why
Mark said he was. Yeah, in the here's lobby, a real thing it. That Eliza said to me when we were walking into the studio. Because I was telling her how good Gravity was, and Eliza, what do you? You're like, well, I don't want to see it because I don't want it.
I don't want that to happen to me.
Oh, you're
and
I'm go
like,
to space.
That's why I didn't see Deep Blue.
Yeah, that was the first thing I thought when I saw the trailer. Yeah. I was like, that is why I will not go to space.
That's why I won't see Saw.
It's like swimming in the ocean is a little easier to do than becoming an astronaut.
Yeah, but you know what but at one point, swimming in the ocean was just as unreachable as space.
That was never an issue. We actually swam from the ocean onto the shore. Yeah.
Guys, that's it evolution, is a possibility. That's not real. Yes. Because freaking Mark Burnett just got a show picked up that's Race to Space.
Yeah, and you have to spend millions of dollars for one seat.
But one day you won't.
Yeah, no, you win this reality TV show and you get to go to space.
Fuck, I don't want reality contestants going to space. Wait. Fucking up
Eliza's
space.
Actually won a reality show already.
As the winner of last... No, I'm
you should be ineligible. It's like McDonald's employees playing Monopoly. They're not allowed to do it. So
really?
You're ineligible. You're grounded.
Well, that's
you're
what they do now.
Then I'll see Gravity.
I'm grounded by Gravity. They're bringing Last Comic Standing back and the winner gets a tour in space.
I think that's where Dad Van is right now. Dad Van will be playing one of the rings of Saturn.
Poor Dad Van.
Come see me the Chucklehead on Jupiter this Friday.
Well, that's
opening for Pluto Nash, Iliza Shelsinger.
Eliza, where are you performing next?
I'm gonna be at the. Is that music?
Yes, music.
At the is that space?
There's space playing you off.
Space me. Oh, I have to leave. Make this speech quick. I'll be at the Fort Lauderdale Improv this coming weekend. Not this coming week. The next one, and then the Tempe Improv, and all the dates are on my website. Yep. Eliza.com. And Eliza. I tweet about them.
Okay, cool.
And this weekend, you can see Eliza and I have platonic drinks at the Comedy Store Friday and Saturday night.
Got a bunch of shows this weekend if you live here.
All right, well, Eliza, we're going to have you back for a full show where you can talk about maybe horror films. That would be great to have you back, yes?
Yeah, Insidious 2.
What did you think of that one?
I loved it.
Did you love it?
I loved the first one.
See, I didn't love the second. Did you? I liked The Conjuring. I liked The Conjuring. I liked a lot.
I was peer pressured into saying I liked The Conjuring more than I did. I went on a date to see it, and he was like, oh, it's just so good, and I didn't want him to feel like he spent all the time and money for nothing.
Orlando Bloom?
I went with Orlando Bloom. So like, did you like it? I was like, he did. Your mustache is thin.
That's why you broke up. I get it. All right.
That's why I broke his heart.
It was great to have Eliza with us, and I'm glad that you got all the support. You deserved it from the fans and everybody else, too. That's why we retweeted you out. And for some reason, she's not following us anymore, so we're going to make sure she does that again.
Get out your phone.
Yeah. Mark said to unfollow.
Whoa.
I was drunk in a fit of rage after Eliza beat me at darts late one night. Make sure you guys check out Eliza's new special, War Paint, on Netflix and available on iTunes.
All right, guys. Thanks, we'll be right back at 8:30 with Clare Kramer. All right.
Oh my God, this...
You're listening to the Toad Hop Network, radio worth watching.
What's up, Toadheads? Hey, make sure you check out the Toad Hop store on ToadHopNetwork.com. It's a great way to support the network and helps continue to bring you quality programming.
Quality programming, my ass.
Can you see I'm recording you, a-hole?
So maybe you've got a great idea for a business and want to start selling your products or services online. Maybe you're an established business owner looking for new customers. Or maybe you're interested in starting a personal website. No matter who you are, GoDaddy wants to help you kick ass online. Right now, GoDaddy's offering .com domains for just $1.99. It's go time. Start your website today. Visit GoDaddy.com and enter promo code TOAD to get your $1.99.com or click on the GoDaddy graphic on the Toad Hop website. Some limitations apply. See website for details.
To leave your house to shop, to crawl through traffic to the mall.
Just to find the thing you wanted.
Isn't even there at all.
Amazon.com is the answer.
Shop at home in style and ease.
Find exactly what you want.
Ordering your stuff's a breeze.
Books on tape.
Games galore.
Everything you're looking for.
Kindle. Cameras. Electronics.
Baby Einstein.
Hooked on Phonics.
Blu-ray.
Movies.
And TV.
Download.
Music.
MP3.
Pixar.
Disney.
Microphones.
Pet supplies and doggy bones.
World of Warcraft.
Nancy Drew.
Sims.
The Scruff System too.
Click Amazon.
You'll smile with glee.
Sometimes shipping's even free.
What's up, everyone? Sports Guru here. Sick of looking at the same old boring websites? Well, check out the new sportsguru.com for all the hottest trending videos and all the biggest sports news. Become a VIP for only $4.99 and get premium access to everything the Sports Guru has to offer. The beautiful gurus, girls, all my biggest sports picks, and much more. So get off that porn site and check out the new sportsguru.com.
Is that hunk of junk you call a car always breaking down and leaving you in the dust? Log on to Dyson-Motors.com and check out Dyson's full inventory online. With hundreds of quality cars in stock of all makes and models, you can find the next car of your dreams in minutes. And know you're getting super low pricing. Purchase a car today from Dyson Motors and receive a year of free oil changes. Bad credit? Worried about financing? Log on and get pre-approved in seconds. Go to Dyson-Motors.com and find your new car today.
With Gamefly, choose from over 6,000 titles. Play as long as you want and send them back when you're done. $8.95 to start. No late fees. Gamefly.com. Games delivered.
You're listening to the Toad Hop Network. Radio worth watching.
Oh my God, that is the epic sound of the greatest metal band of all time, Metallica. Welcome back to the Schmoes No Movies podcast. Christian Harloff over there. I am Mark Ellis. Thank you, Iliza Shelsinger, for joining us. And now we have another special guest joining us via telephone. It is the host of the fellow Toad Hopper, Sean Astin, host of Vox Populi. Sean, thank you so much for calling in. How are you, my friend?
Well, you're a good host, man. I don't think I answer phones as good as you do.
I was practicing that. I practiced Eliza's intro. I practiced that one.
And I knew it. Preparing. Yeah, and Sean, I knew he was going to do it. He's like, I want to intro Sean. I was like, fine. Sean, how are you, man? So
doing great.
Yeah, we want to hear. We were lucky to run into you at Comic-Con. We got to chat a little bit there and talk about your projects that's coming up. But we hear you got something new you're working on right now.
Well, first of all, I'm calling you from my dressing room in Toronto, Canada, where I'm working all night on our television show, The Strain, which is written, produced, and directed by Guillermo del Toro.
I finished book one of The Strain. It's one of the rare ones. Guillermo del Toro and Chuck Hogan, I believe, co-wrote it. And I was reading it and thinking this needs to be some sort of visual thing so I don't have to read the next two books. So I can just watch and enjoy
it. So I can be lazy.
Yeah, and that's so exciting.
Oh my God. That's why you should have paid attention in high school. The books are amazing. I got another way to spoon feed it to you. You got Ron Perlman reads the audiobooks, and he is so good.
Wow,
he's so good. Is just the descriptions it's a vampire trilogy of books. I like trilogies, but it's a vampire trilogy, and it's not treated like. Well, you read it. How would you describe it?
Yeah, it's kind of grounded in reality. And it has this kind of fantastical thing
did
where there's
you
this.
Really read the book
yeah, there's an airplane.
He wouldn't say it.
An airplane. I own it. Airplane takes off and it lands, and then there's just all these dead people. So you get an airplane full of dead people.
Right.
How did it land? Where did it come from? And that investigation kind of takes you into this dark underworld, and it has all of those kind of like ancient curses and things like that associated with vampiredom. So there's a lot of moving parts in it. And again, like I don't know what happens in The Strain.
Right.
Let me go for that. Okay, that was. So if we're auditioning pitches, that was one.
How was it? How did he do?
Let me go.
I think he sort of got it all right and all wrong.
Sean, I shot my wad with your intro, buddy.
He totally read the Cliff's Notes, and that's where he's pitching.
He's reading Wikipedia right now. So Sean, what so can you tell us
about? What he did is that's what his feeling was. You know, I mean, it's the thing is, if a plane lands at LaGuardia and it's one of 50 planes landing at LaGuardia, and it kind of pulls over to the right, and all of a sudden it turns all its lights and shuts down, and you're like, whoa, what's going on that plane?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, and then you got the air traffic control. What's going on there? Like, are we having a terrorist incident? And then they, you know, they don't know, are they going to approach it? Is the plane going to blow up? Do they go in there? All the shades are down. There's no power to anything. It takes them a half hour to get oriented, and then are they going to send somebody in? Are they going to send like a robot in? And when they get in there, what's going on? All the bodies are dead, yeah. But they're all perfectly, there's nothing wrong with them. They're just dead.
So is there almost like is it kind of like what Walking Dead did with that feel of like, you know, the realistic tone, although obviously different, it's not walkers and the zombies, but with the vampire, is Guillermo going for that tone of the almost more realistic?
It's even more realistic. Okay. It's like, what happens if you're sitting at a desk at the CDC and you get a call and you're going to decide like, whoa, is this a terrorist incident? Is this some sort of a virus? And they treat the whole vampire thing like it's an outbreak.
Wow. So like World War Z style.
Yeah. We need to contain it in terms of the way you would contain an airborne virus.
And what about your character? Different. Can you tell us anything about your character?
Are you a vampire?
I'm Jim Kent. I'm the the logistics guy, basically the sidekick Corey Stoll, who is on our Canary team. It's the sort of the rapid reaction force from the Centers for Disease Control. So that's all I can say.
All right, well, we just hope you don't get trapped in a gas room this time.
But listen, I want to say one thing. You know, the show, my show, Vox Populi.
Yes.
Which it means voice of the people, but the title of the show for your listeners who don't give a crap about my show is, I'm trying to get them, you know, but it's called Vox Populi, voice of the occasionally interested, we put in quotes, people. And we've done 36 episodes, and now we're going to take it to the next level. So I'm actually doing something you guys are going to want to do. I've launched a Kickstarter campaign.
Okay.
And we're raising $30,000 so that imagine if you had $30,000 to produce this show right now. Like, yeah. What would you do with 30 grand?
Oh,
a lot of it goes to beer.
Oh, no.
You asked the wrong crew. Doing?
No, well, my show's a political show, and I need to hire, we need to staff up. I don't want to take up too much time on the show, but we basically, it's been an amazing 4 days. The first 4 days of the campaign, we've raised just about 15 grand. I think we're
wow,
like 14, that's awesome
for you.
Like that.
So where can our fans go? What tell us a little bit more about it. And where
can
our fans
help?
Go?
How yeah, can they pitch in?
Oh well, for people who don't know what Kickstarter is, basically, it used to be like if you had a garage band and you wanted to like do a record. There were securities laws that would say, like, you can't do that. You know, if you wanted to make a movie, you can't go to grandma and say, grandma, can I have $10,000 because I need to make my movie? Because the government's job was to protect grandma from getting taken advantage of. So, you know, if grandma had $1 million in net worth or more, then she could give you your $10,000 for your independent film that you wanted to make. Well, they changed the laws, and they made it now so that you can do this thing called crowdsourcing, which is you can go out to the public like I'm doing right now. This would have been totally illegal a year and a half ago to come on a radio show and say, hey, will you support my creative endeavor financially? It would have been breaking securities law. Now, you can go into Kickstarter.com and you can look at people who are making paintings, they're doing books, they're doing all these different things. Well, I'm doing Vox Populi, the radio show, and I want to hire a full-time producer and a part-time social media person who can help run the show. I want to get a booker who knows the ins and outs of Washington, D.C., so I can be getting all the congressmen and senators that I want on the phone when I want them on the phone and this kind of thing. But basically, you go on to Kickstarter.com, you type in my name, Sean Astin, and then you hit the word back, and the amount of money you decide to support is they have these rewards. So for like $5, you get, whatever it is. I mean, for $5, you get your name. We're going to put on the screen all the people who gave $5, like on the premiere episode
of
the
cool.
second season. And then like a really cool one. We have these wristbands, these cool wristbands. For $25, you get a wristband. And that's basically it. The people, and it's been, you know, on the Twitter feed and Facebook and everything, people have just been getting excited because the premise, like right now the government is shut down.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, why can't these leaders learn how to talk to each other? And the whole premise of my show is civil discourse. Learn how to talk about, are you a pro-life? Are you a pro-choice? Let's get everybody who disagrees in a forum and learn how to speak respectfully.
Healthy debate. Yeah.
Your
well, and I think just your podcast itself is a great place for people to go because like there is so much going on in the government right now and people want to go to a place where they can just listen to people chat about it in an approachable kind of way.
Right.
Yeah, there's so much going on. Well, there's nothing going on in the government right now. But there's, you know, there's so much going on in politics right now. And so you can just go to Sean's Kickstarter campaign. Just go to Kickstarter.com, type in Sean Astin, and help him get producers and bookers. Hey, Sean, if you want an intern, we're happy to throw you ours.
Yeah, please.
The guy does nothing but sleep all day.
They're pretty cute. I don't know, man. I'm watching this. I'm watching on the computer here. I don't know. Why are you guys even in there with these?
That's not. Those aren't our interns. Those are. That's our co-host and our guest.
Did you just assume that the two girls in here were the interns?
Now, Sean, make sure you watch this. JTI, come here, and let's show him how cute you are. Stick your face right in there.
This is what you get, Mr. Astin. Free of charge.
Get out of here. That's.
I just wasn't sure, like, how sexist you were being. Yeah.
Well, Sean, thank you so much for calling in. Very happy. Look, 15,000 already, dude. What's that?
I said that's awesome.
That's really fast. So you're gonna hit it. And again, when
I thought he was kind of cute. I have a little bit of a delay here. I think he's kind of cute.
Sean thinks you're cute, Josh. Don't go crying just yet. He likes you.
He is. Okay.
Thank you so much for joining the show, Sean. And make sure you let Guillermo know that when you guys are done with the strain, he's welcome to come on the podcast anytime.
Absolutely.
As are you.
You guys together.
I'll bring him with me.
I would love that. You got to come back soon, man. We'll do that Oscar thing again.
That was fun. That was good stuff. You guys do a great job. You guys are so knowledgeable. You know, I mean, that's why you. How many people listen to your show? Like 4 or 5 people? How many people are listening?
Everyone in this room. That's it. We literally just do it for each other. Yeah. So
I know people are listening to your show because you've got advertising. On my show, it's like, it's just me. You can hear crickets.
Well, Sean,
we had Johnny on the boards over there told me that we had 24,000 people on our special edition about Syria a week ago.
Wow. That's great.
So I was it's none of you, you know, big movie comedy kind of guys who pull in your 800,000. But for me to have 24,000 people willing to kind of think about, talk about the government, talk about, you know, I was pretty happy about that.
Well, we love what you do, and we can't wait to see you in studio, man. So have fun. Kick ass out there like we know you will, and we'll see you soon.
Bless you all. Thanks so much. Have a great rest of your show.
All right, guys. Bye. Sean Astin.
Sean Astin, ladies and gentlemen. It's just so cool to have that guy that, like, we grew up watching in movies, we've had him in studio before. He's such a cool guy. And now what's really fun is to make the transition from talking about the strain and vampires running around to big-ass spiders.
Oh,
we
are
joined in studio by Clare Kramer. Claire, how are you, ma'am?
What's up, Claire?
Oh, man, I'm good. Thanks for having me, you guys.
It's really nice to have you in studio. We're glad to talk to you. We've going to have to ask you about Buffy. We have to ask you about Buffy.
Of course. That's a prerequisite.
Have to. It's a definite. We're going to ask you about Buffy for sure, and we want to hear all about Big Ass Spider, which is going to be released on October 18th.
Yes, it's coming into the theaters October 18th.
All right, so let's talk about that first. Let's talk about what exactly is... but I mean, I know that there's a... It's about a big spider, or alien spider.
Really?
It's about a big ass
spider.
Isn't it an alien?
It's not a species of spider known to Earth, Christian, which would make it therefore an
alien. It is part,
no, wait,
you know,
Makuga, go fuck yourself. He just give me a crash. Is it not? Is the spider an alien?
The spider is part extraterrestrial.
So blow it out your ass, but, wild man. Yeah. This guy's looking at me like, that's not right. Actually, he's Italian. Asshole.
He's from the Netherlands. The spider is this mutant spider, clearly, that at the beginning of the film, comes into this hospital in a body bag, and as the spider devours human flesh, sort of like a zombie. Yeah.
Generally what mutants zombie who are part extraterrestrial do is
vampire.
Devour humans.
Right. Yeah. It grows exponentially in size, and it grows over a very short period of time. So through the course of like 12 hours, it starts off, you know, the size of a baseball and becomes the size of, you know, the Empire State Building.
So it's like the blob almost.
In spider form with 8 legs.
Yeah, but the blob, the blob wasn't
also
as
an alien
athletic. You know, the blob just kind of sat there in the middle. This spider can go around all over the place.
Spiders surprisingly are very agile, you know.
When you try to kill a spider, it's not the easiest task in the world. So let me ask you this. So to kill a giant alien spider, do you call the military or do you call the Orkin man?
Well, you call both. They called the military, which is where my character comes in.
Uh-huh.
I play Lieutenant Carly Bryant, who is kicking some major military ass.
Mm-hmm.
And she's very staunch and kind of you know, just straight up serious about her job. And Greg Grunberg from Heroes and Alias, who I love, who's awesome. He plays the Western exterminator guy.
Nice.
Who comes to the hospital actually to get he has a bite that he's getting tended to, and he just, you know, falls into the situation of trying to help the military, and we kind of work tandemly, and we kind of fall in love, and then he rescues me from the spider.
See, I could land a hot chick. If there was a giant spider running around LA, I could be like, hey, this could be our last night on Earth. Yeah. I happen to be an exterminator.
You're pretty
let's
good.
Hook
yeah.
up.
So
all
here's right. my yeah, question.
You've killed a lot of spiders in your apartment.
There's a spider battle. Shelob versus the spider in your movie.
Now, who is
Shelob is from Lord of the Rings.
Right. Oh, yes. Okay, all right.
It would be the spider.
Would really? Win.
Yeah.
Really?
I mean, let me pose a question to you guys. How do you think you kill a big ass spider?
With all the weapons that we have?
Gut.
I think
do you get to its gut, though?
I don't know, you slide under it with a sword.
It has a crispy shell. Running.
I think your character, Claire, I think your character is going to figure it out because...
I think you shoot near its heart.
I think you're going to find some specialized weapon that some scientist is going to blow this thing's ass off.
No, her boyfriend and her are going to come up with it.
Maybe.
Hey, well, from what she describes, she's going to find a specialized weapon in the exterminator's pants because they're hooking up throughout this movie.
It's going to be an ass of spider.
Definitely that happens.
You know, and I want everybody, I know there's a lot of politicians listening to this show. You guys need to pay attention. Get the government back up and running because if we have a big ass spider attack us and there's no military fighting, then it's just exterminators.
That's the one thing
they'll
never.
Doesn't the clown turn into a giant spider in it?
The clown?
Maybe.
Might turn into
that
a
sounds
giant
very
spider.
Stephen King ish.
A giant spider, but not a big ass spider.
But not just a big spider.
Well, I have a question, though, in regards to a big ass spider with the title like that.
Yes.
So
everyone just likes saying it.
It's not a. I'm guessing here, but it doesn't seem like a straight up horror film. It seems like there's going to be a lot of humor in it.
It is Ghostbusters meets Cloverfield.
Great.
It is very funny. Okay. Very funny. You cannot
And it's aware of itself.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I wouldn't say it's camp. It's not
Sharknado.
It walks the line. Yeah. It's nothing like Sharknado. People love to compare it to Sharknado because obviously Sharknado has, I don't know, giants. I actually haven't seen Sharknado.
Well, when you get
has
a
anyone
title?
Seen it?
No.
I'll give you the breakdown. What it is, it's a tornado
with
sharks.
Right, and I did see the clip where Ian Ziering
cuts out
is
of the
like,
gut. That's
yeah,
the
he's like, yeah. But no, it's nothing like that. It's definitely. I mean, Mike Mendez directs. If you've seen any of his movies, I worked with him in 2005 on a movie called Grave Dancers, which was really great. He did The Convent back, I think, in 2001. He's a huge horror fanatic, but he has this unique sensibility that he's very funny, you know. So in his directing, both aspects kind of come out, and it makes for a very enjoyable film.
And it's going to be available October 18th.
Yeah,
it is in theaters October 18th. I think it's also on demand same day. Yeah,
that's a lot of movies seem to be doing that now, where it comes out in a theater and then the same day it's available on demand.
It's smart.
Yeah, but it's like five times as much as the other movies on demand. So that's kind of, you know.
But
I mean, I guess that's good for our movies, but for me as a consumer, I'm always like, why?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you with all the kids.
Well,
yeah.
No, but that's true, though. They charge probably like $12 or $13.
Yeah,
more.
I know. You're probably not watching alone.
But yeah, but it's also because it's a newer release. Yeah. And think about it. It actually makes sense, though, too, because if there's a newer, let's say for once in a couple, a year or two, 3 years from now, they're going to start doing really big releases. And let's say something like Gravity is on demand. And you're not going to go to the movies. You have your surround sound. You have everything. And your family of three or four can pay it. And you're not paying the $20, $30, $40
even more antisocial.
Yeah, it's true.
I just want to spend more time alone by myself on my couch.
You know that when you go to the theater anyway, you're like, I wish all these people were home.
No, I go to the movies and I invite 10 friends, especially to big midnight shows.
Are you kidding me? Listen to what you guys are saying. There's giant big ass spiders out there in LA. I'm staying holed up inside watching on DirecTV things.
When you talk about the humor, though, and you talk about that kind of mixture, someone that's been great at doing that, if you go to Cabin in the Woods, is Joss Whedon, who you have some experience with.
Yes, I was fortunate enough to work with Joss on a little show called Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Little show, you stop it.
And, you know, it was kind of, Joss had obviously had great success before then, but he was still very involved with Buffy. He was directing episodes. Yeah. He directed a lot of the episodes I was in. And he's just, you know, he's such a truly creative savant, you know? Yeah. I mean, he is. He writes, he directs. His writing is phenomenal. I love the cadence of his language. And I think that's actually what kind of the through line of all his projects has been.
Right.
And he, you know, even with the Avengers, you see that humor come out in the most serious situations.
Yeah. And well, you worked with him. Do you still keep in touch with him? Or
The last time I saw him was maybe a couple months ago. Yeah, okay. Definitely. Oh, definitely.
Because now you have the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. out there, and then you have all these new movies he's got his hands into.
Yeah, definitely.
Probably not a bad time to keep emailing him.
He really is like the puppet master of the Marvel Universe now, because he's got his hands in everything, and because he knocked Avengers so far out of the park. I mean, can you foresee anything like that with Buffy?
Well, I mean, just on the note of the S.H.I.E.L.D. and Avengers, I thought it was really interesting how the S.H.I.E.L.D. sort of picked up and talked about what happened in Avengers, you know, and kind of like carried it through like that. I thought that was really smart. And so it makes me wonder about the next Avengers movie, where that's going to start. Do I see anything carrying through with Buffy like that? I think there probably is going to be a little bit more of a moratorium with the brand, the Buffy brand and the character.
Yeah.
Because right now it's at an interesting point where I don't think the Scooby Gang is, you know, I don't think you can bring them back as is. Not enough time has passed for them to get old enough and evolved enough. But too soon, you know.
It'd be interesting. Yeah.
I don't know. But
did Christy Swanson ever guest on the show at anything? Cameo? No. I'd like to see a Christy Swanson battle with Sarah Michelle Gellar.
I would like to see Sarah Michelle Gellar have to stab Robin Williams in the heart on The Good Ones, and then that's like the then it goes right back into Buffy.
Christy Swanson is waiting.
And she's just like, and then the music starts.
And so how long were you
on? I don't
think
you're alone on that, by the way.
I haven't seen it. I love Robin Williams, but, you know, it didn't look great.
It could get better. It could get better.
Do you I mean, because we had Katie Sackhoff on too. She's always talking about
I love Katie. She's so sweet.
She's awesome. Yeah. So, well, she's always talking about on Battlestar how it's funny because, and we'll get this with Breaking Bad as well, how DVDs have really gone and changed television in general. So do you find now people who maybe, you know, maybe just started watching Buffy recently are coming up to you and saying, hey, the great episode of Buffy.
Absolutely. Like you're on last night. And you know, it's like, it's one of those shows that, you know, I always say I won the lottery when I got cast on Buffy, because the longevity, you know, who knew? At that point, I had no idea what I was walking into. But people are passing it down like a family heirloom. They're passing it to their, you know, children or younger siblings or friends, and people are being introduced to it on a continuous basis. So really, almost every time I talk about the show, there's a group of people who have not, you know, who have just been introduced within the last year.
And they check it out and stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm sure a lot of Schmoville will be checking out if they haven't seen it. Make sure you check out Clare Kramer in the older episodes of Buffy. And you're our second Buffy cast member, I think, that we've had.
Who else did you have?
Danny Strong.
I love Danny.
Yeah, we had Danny on as well.
Danny and I went head to head. It was down to the two of us in a celebrity poker tournament.
Oh, really?
I think it was like 2003 in Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
Super fun.
Another guy awesome. You should send an email to.
Awesome guy. I love Danny. He's pure heart of gold. Yeah. He's amazing. I'm so happy for his success.
So when you're not battling vampires or giant spiders,
yeah,
you're gambling.
Yeah, I want to hear about the story. All right, so the two of you guys.
I am a gambler.
Nice. Yeah? All right.
Of course. I
you
love
came on
I
this
mean,
show. You have to
hello.
Be.
You know, I'm competitive.
Is poker your main poison when you're in Vegas, or are you more of a blackjack dame? You just throw it all in roulette? What do you got?
Well, it depends on the situation.
Steve?
If it's the start of the week. No, it depends on where I am, like, with
how
you
much
know,
you already
in
lost,
the weekend,
how long you're going
to
be there.
Like, my go-to, like, to win stuff back, if I have, like, 3 hours left in Vegas, definitely roulette. You know, I mean, you can't make money faster than you can on that table. But I can sit at a blackjack table I can make, you know, $500 last however long I need
What was your best night? What was your worst?
Well, we won't discuss my worst. Because
You haven't told me, but he has.
Well, I will say this.
It involves commas.
He lost lost your shoes.
It involves commas and decimal points. I will say this. I've done a couple of the celebrity cruises, and one of the greatest parts of a cruise is that there's a casino on the water. And there were times where, like, my whole goal was to, like, pay off, like, what I had charged on my room by the end of the trip. So.
Yeah. She's like, you ever seen Leaving Las Vegas?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm not so much like the Nicolas Cage character. But
like Craps is one, you know, we saw Runner this and it's coming out this weekend. Runner, again, it's another one of these gambling movies where it always looks like it's so much fun at the craps table. And then I'm a blackjack man myself, and I'm in Vegas a fair amount. So when I go to Vegas, I always see the craps table, and I'm like, God, I want to be that. I want to be Bob Redford.
Yeah.
Just with the dice, just
and
throwing
it never works out that way.
Have you ever played craps? Do you understand how the game works?
Yeah, definitely. Well, I mean... But it's not, I completely agree with you. It's not as, I mean, it can be really exciting. Craps is a game, in my opinion, so you have philosophies for all the games in the casino. Craps is one of the games that you have to have a big, you have to come with a group, you got to have your partner.
So they can pull their money together?
I mean?
No, one more.
So at least one of you wins. Everybody, like whoever gets on the roll, you just all go with that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it's not a game that you want to just like saunter up and just try to take part in. Whereas blackjack, if you sit down at a table, you know, you can easily befriend the patrons there if they're playing the right way.
I am loved at a blackjack table. Yeah. I'm either loved and occasionally hated at a blackjack table.
If they start hitting when they shouldn't and staying when they shouldn't, then I'm out of there because they're going to lose my money faster than they're going to lose
rookies.
Their own.
Well, you know, you mentioned runner.
Uh-huh.
And again, because we have Claire for a little bit. Now, you're a big movie girl as well, yes?
Yes, I like gambling movies.
So Runner is a movie that's coming out this weekend, as Mark mentioned, and that's got Justin Timberlake and Ben Affleck.
Mm-hmm.
And Timberlake is a Princeton guy who is running a online gambling racket at his school, and then he gets ripped off and finds out that the reason why is from the online gambling tycoon that has won Ben Affleck, who's running his racket from Costa Rica, which is actually shot in Puerto Rico.
You just had to throw that in there, didn't you?
Had to.
Bitter.
So they and that's where it's basically we've saw the movie and you want to see the review, go to youtube.com/Mosno and it is
it's a fun cable movie. It's very watchable, especially the first half, and then like Christian made the point that it throws one curveball at you and you're like, you're gonna keep me off balance, and then it just kind of mails it in, takes it by the book.
It reminded me of like a 99-cent version of Wall Street.
Mm.
You know, it's just very predictable, beat by beat.
But such a watchable, you know, when you get a villain and you're almost rooting for the villain by the end of the movie, you're like, you know, I like Timberlake, he's adorable. I want to see what Affleck does with these crocodiles.
Well, that was the question I wanted to ask you guys. Do you think that Justin Timberlake is a movie star?
No.
A leading man. Okay. Tiffany is very...
Okay, Tiffany doesn't need to elaborate, apparently.
I am absolutely on your side, but I want... Claire, do you think that he's a movie star?
As an actor, I think that... This is a real answer here. I think that you really can't judge someone unless you're judging per performance. You know what I mean?
Agreed.
So, you know, if you have to analyze each performance, in terms of being a leading man, we don't have what we had in the 50s and 60s. We don't have the, you know, Cary Grant.
Yeah, but you still have people like, again, look at a Ben Affleck who, by the way, and I am on record giving him some shit in the past for stuff that he's done. But then this movie, he is electric in the scenes that he's in. The movie itself, the dialogue, not so great, but you can't stop watching him. He is a leading man. Justin Timberlake is a guy. He's great.
Justin Timberlake in a movie.
Absolutely.
That's the
And he doesn't. He feels like he's reading lines. He never really. That's the difference as far as the leading man goes. I don't really feel like he's in the character.
Right.
I'm going to disagree.
I haven't seen the movie yet.
Yeah. Here's what I'll go with Justin Timberlake. Is by the way, comparing him to Affleck's a little unfair because Affleck's been acting since the early '90s, and Affleck had a period where he was just Ben Affleck on screen, where it's like, Ben Affleck in a shitty rom com or an action movie, and then he kind of learned from his mistakes
when he was Bennifer.
Yeah, right. when he was doing all that stuff, and Timberlake really came on the scene as far as, hey, this guy really wants to be a serious actor in The Social Network, and he used his charisma, his natural onstage presence so well in that movie, and then In
great.
Time comes out, and In Time it was a major step back, because In Time he looked like he was treading water and kind of drowning a little bit in such a complex role, and then this one comes back, and I think he started to show that potential again, so I'd say give the kid a shot.
See, I don't think he had I think that it's along the same line, but Claire, you were making the point that you hadn't seen the movie yet, but
I have not seen the movie yet. But I mean, I don't dislike him as an actor. And today, our definition of leading man has changed. I mean, look at someone like Jeremy Renner. If you saw him in Dahmer, would you ever think that he would be the next Bourne? You know, taking over the Bourne franchise.
I didn't mean by look.
No, but I mean
acting ability. I think Jeremy Renner is in a different level.
He's another Buffy alum, by the way.
Yeah, is he really?
I think he did one or two episodes.
Renner did.
Renner though has just and because it's his craft. You know, Timberlake was a musician thrown into acting, as where Jeremy Renner is an actor. Mm. And, like, so I think that I know what you're saying, though, too, there are different shapes of, like, you know, the Robert Redford leading man, then the Jeremy Renner leading man. But, I mean, there's still ability. I don't think he's got the ability, is what I'm going to say, the chops.
Right. And I reserve judgment. I'm not passing judgment on that yet.
Fair
enough.
I got
to see the movie.
I think the jury's still out a little bit.
And I think, I mean, you have experience with this where you've done a role, like in Buffy or even in Bring It On, where people always associate you with that. So for Justin, where it's like everyone just is always going to associate celebrate him as this musician.
As the greatness that was NSYNC.
How do you battle that? Like, I'm sure you've had to deal with it.
I think that, I mean, it's all about choices. And I think at least what I can say about his choices, he's trying to make interesting choices. He may not always succeed in them, but he's not just running out and doing, you know, every low-budget horror movie or whatever that comes along. I'm sure he gets a million offers a day, you know, and he's trying to make...
Right, the best decision.
You know, he's kind of doing what Katie Holmes did after Dawson's Creek. She didn't just... She took, like, select roles up until...
Married a Scientologist?
Oh, no. Up until that. But, you know, with, like, the gift and, and Go, and she had some really cool roles, you know, and she was trying to break away from the Joey character, and you know, I kind of see him along that trajectory.
Yeah. But we all know that Timberlake's a good-looking guy, and I've been compared to Timberlake before. On the show, people said that I kind of look like Justin Timberlake. If I'm at a high school rave and it's really dark and there's glow sticks around, you'll think I'm Timberlake.
And I have I have Vicks under my nose. And
yeah.
Well, thank you, Claire. I appreciate that.
There you go. And then, now the other movie, we have about 5 minutes left. So the other movie that we have to talk about is Gravity.
I'm done.
Now,
I'll see you guys.
No, listen. I'm the only one here besides myself and Yodi. By the way, Yodi, who's sitting over to the left, he saw it with me as well. No one else has seen it yet.
Have you seen it?
I have not seen it. We sent people to see it.
Yeah.
We had a review come out on the site today, and I know like our staff absolutely loved it.
Look, I'm not going to spoil anything in the movie, but this thing, holy, I mean, if you've seen this trailer, it is nothing what you think it's going to be.
Well, first of all, I've heard that it's like, and you can agree or disagree because I'm curious because you've seen it and I haven't.
I feel like I'm at a really shitty dinner party where one guy's seen it. It's like, you guys.
I feel like I'm at a great dinner party.
Conversation. Yeah. Give him another beer. Yeah.
You're that asshole around the campfire with the acoustic guitar. Let me tell you about
that time.
Yeah. I call this next song Gravity.
Sandra Bullock was my baby in space.
I don't know what,
but I hear
right
it's like a generation-defining film.
It is
that it's so, you know, that it's so intense and unique. So what makes it that?
It's it is that groundbreaking thing. And say what you will about Avatar in story and tone and whatnot, a lot of people have their problems with it. But no one can disagree that Avatar is a groundbreaking in technology, and this is one of those movies. You see it from the opening shot, and you know, all right, this is something special. And it is absolutely, and I've said this 1,000 times already, but like I literally turned to Mark Riley and I said, right before the movie started, I said, I don't know if I need to see this movie in 3D because I'm sick of 3D. You absolutely need to see this movie in 3D.
Oh, really? Okay.
And absolutely need to see it in IMAX. It's shot for it. It's not just a studio tool. There's a reason it's in 3D. There's a reason it's shot in IMAX. And it's just, it's the sound, it's the score, it's the performances, it's everything you want from a movie. And I never have anxiety watching a movie. I did in a good way.
Okay.
And it just, you're just wrapped up. It's my favorite movie of the year.
The interesting thing, I watched some interviews with Sandra Bullock, and she was just talking about the fact that, you know, she would have to voice over the stuff multiple times. So it was like, she would do it in the suit and then she'd have to do it again and like get herself to that point again. And I'm like, that's when you hear people talking about that and knowing how far they would push themselves to get that. And when you're watching it and she's on the screen by herself for a large majority of the film.
Here's what I'm worried about. And look, I like 2001 A Space Odyssey as much as the next Stone College Kid. I really do. It was an achievement in cinema. But it's a longer movie and it takes a while to get what it's doing. And it does that on purpose. And so what I'm worried about with Gravity, me having the small bladder I do, from the trailer, it looks like one of these movies is going to be like 2.5 hours and it's just plotting and it's a little slow going, but a great acting showcase.
You're in.
Tell me I'm wrong.
You're wrong. You're in and you're out. About an hour, a little over an hour and a half. Feels a little longer because you're
that's
so
tidy. That's a tidy. So
yeah, that's rare now.
It's only an hour and a half.
Maybe an hour 40 tops.
Wowzers.
And because you can tell what Alfonso Cuarón is doing. He knows the story he wants to tell. He's not pushing it. He knows his moments. He knows his beats. And he hits it. And he wrote the story for a reason. There was a review out there that I saw, and it's from a respected reviewer, someone that we also, you know, is on YouTube. And I respect her as a reviewer, but she made a point that Sandra Bullock was an annoying character that set women back. I could not disagree more with that statement. It is the exact opposite of that. I feel that what Sandra Bullock does for this character and for women, you have to remember that her character starts off as a woman who's been in the program for 6 months and she's caught in this thing. That's all I will say without ruining everything else.
Wait, we're letting women into space? First you let them vote, and then the next thing you know, they just come in, take over our podcast, and there's nothing else to talk about.
It's really interesting that she's a female reviewer who wrote that. That I'm like, I feel like Sandra Bullock is that actress that every girl just loves.
Yeah.
Like everyone
she did not.
Wants
she went, she hated the whole. She hated the whole movie, and I couldn't. I just couldn't understand the review at all.
Gravity.
That's her point. But Claire, how do you feel about Quran? How do you feel about both Bullock and were you excited before you heard about the reviews of this movie, or is it everything in general?
I have been so excited about this movie that I have not watched one trailer.
Good for you.
Smart.
Because I have not, you know, I heard you guys talking earlier in the show about like there's so many trailers that are released that, you know, studios have really caught on that it doesn't ruin the experience for most people. Most people enjoy seeing the trailers. They give away 90% of the film and people, you know, it hasn't hurt the revenue of the project.
Right.
But for me, I wanted to go into this clean slate. And so I haven't watched any trailers at all. I've been like fast forwarding when they come on my TiVo. And it's definitely a project that's been on my radar for quite a while.
Yeah.
I, you know, as an actress, it's a role you dream of. I do like Sandra Bullock. I wouldn't say like I'm a huge fan, but I really like her. I've followed
her
career.
It's the best she's been. This really is the best.
And that's
she's
what
been.
I hear. Yeah. I hear, you know, I thought she was thought she was really good in Blindside.
Yeah.
I mean, there was something really endearing about that performance.
This is and I can't wait to hear what you think.
Yeah, no, I'm excited. I want to come back and talk about it after.
Please do.
Yes,
please
I'll
do
come
because
back
you
after.
Absolutely should.
Have you seen a Quran's first movie that Christian loves pronouncing? Etu Mama NBN?
Etu Mama Tambien.
Yeah. Have you seen that?
I have, yes.
Is it beautiful? Yes. Did it make you cry? Is that what it's the goal
of
it?
Yeah, it's great. I mean, it's great. You understand why he was, you know, why this was his, you know, tour de force.
Yeah, this movie, Gravity.
Can I ask you one question about Gravity? While they're out there in outer space, do they happen to see any parts that could be a mutant giant spider hurtling towards Earth at the same time?
No, but you guys can see it on October 18th. That would be the big-ass spider. Clare Kramer is in studio. You can follow her at Clare Kramer.
And you know what? Even Big Ass Spider has a Twitter at Big Ass Spider.
Awesome. Yeah.
And also at Geek Nation.
Yep. At Geek Nation as well.
You guys all came on to do the Game of Thrones podcast.
And we will be doing it next season
where
as well.
Where we had our little menage a
quatre.
Menage a trois.
Thank you, Claire, so much for joining us.
Thank you, guys.
You absolutely should come back. We would love to have you.
I will come back and talk movies anytime with you guys.
And Claire, make sure that if you're still in studio when we come back, hold your ears. And if you haven't seen Breaking Bad yet, then we're going to spoil some shit for you in the 9 o'clock hour.
Coming up at 9 o'clock, it's all Breaking Bad. Our buddy Chris Stuckman will be calling in. It's going to be a lot of fun. Enjoy.
You're listening to the Toad Hop Network, radio worth watching.
What's up, Toadheads? Hey, make sure you check out the Toad Hop store on ToadHopNetwork.com. It's a great way to support the network and helps continue to bring you quality programming.
Quality programming, my ass.
Can you see I'm recording, you a**hole?
So maybe you've got a great idea for a business and want to start selling your products or services online. Maybe you're an established business owner looking for new customers. Or maybe you're interested in starting a personal website. No matter who you are, GoDaddy wants to help you kick ass online. Right now, GoDaddy's offering .com domains for just $1.99. It's go time. Start your website today. Visit GoDaddy.com and enter promo code TOAD to get your $1.99.com or click on the GoDaddy graphic on the Toad Hop website. Some limitations apply. See website for details.
What's up, everyone? Sports Guru here. Sick of looking at the same old boring websites? Well, check out the new sportsguru.com for all the hottest trending videos and all the biggest sports news. Become a VIP for only $4.99 and get premium access to everything the Sports Guru has to offer. The beautiful gurus, girls, all my biggest sports picks, and much more. So get off that porn site and check out the new sportsguru.com.
To leave your house to shop, to crawl through traffic to the mall.
Just to find the thing you wanted.
Isn't even there at all.
Amazon.com is the answer.
Shop at home in style and ease.
Find exactly what you want.
Ordering your stuff's a breeze.
Books on tape.
Games galore.
Everything you're looking for.
Kindle.
Cameras. Electronics.
Baby Einstein.
Hooked on phonics.
Blu-ray.
Movies.
And TV.
Download.
Music.
MP3.
Pixar.
Disney.
Microphone.
Pet supplies and doggy bones.
World of Warcraft.
Nancy Drew.
Sims.
The Scruff.
System 2.
Click Amazon.
You'll smile with glee.
Sometimes shipping's even free.
With GameFly, choose from over 6,000 titles. Play as long as you want and send them back when you're done. $8.95 to start, no late fees. GameFly.com, games delivered.
Live
from the Toad Hop Network studios
in Hollywood,
this
is the ToadHopNetwork.com.
Enhances the senses, opens your mind.
Radio worth watching.
Radio worth watching.
Oh, yeah. I still get excited hearing it. Especially now when you know what scene from Five. Oh. Oh, it's so good. The show. Talking about Breaking Bad,
God,
guys.
I love this show so much. No. I've watched the finale three times.
No, we're gonna
I just like how Mark's missing and the two of them
two
like
apes jump
creep in.
I know.
Hi, Tiffany.
But neither of you guys are sitting down. You're just like
they just want to listen to the music. So, and even Johnny Ice gets his mug in there.
I'm just staring at
all
Tiffany.
Well, guys, we only have about 50 minutes to talk about Breaking Bad. Six seasons, really. So before we do that, I got to get into one thing here that I want to talk to you guys about. Then we're going full Breaking Bad. We're going to talk about our greatest moments that we loved about it. Our buddy Chris Stuckman's going to call in, talk about his moments. And then we're going to have, we're going to talk about the finale as well at the end. But before we do that, I've told you guys about my buddy Kevin Barringer, who is a he owns Body Boxing Boot Camp, and he has a fundraising campaign going on at Indigo, IndieGoGo.com to raise money to open a fitness gym so that he can just keep kicking ass as much as he. You know, this guy's awesome. Like, he really is a great trainer, and I've talked to you guys about it already. Mm-hmm. There will be a lot of gifts and perks in it if you go there and you donate some money. Every dollar counts, so even like the little smallest donation will help. Just go to IndieGoGo.com and type in Body Boxing Boot Camp in the search bar. You can also go to www.3bbootcamp.com to check him and the boot camp out and see what type of ass kicking he does every week. So, all right, that being said,
I need that for when I come on the podcast.
Listen, I'll tell you what, you would love this guy, Tiffany. He really is good. He kicks serious ass. He's great. All right, so now stepping in the studio is Jesse Pinkman.
AKA Justin
bitch.
Timberlake.
Jesse, sit down, you idiot. We're going to talk about Breaking Bad here. We're really pumped. Everybody in the studio is caught up. I was worried that Johnny Ice wasn't going to be caught. He's caught up. Tiffany's caught up.
Johnny Ice caught up.
Ken hasn't watched The Gremlins, so who cares?
He wasn't allowed to.
No. So let's get into this. I want to talk to Schmoville about it, too. So when we ask, as far as tweet in, at Schmoes, no. Tell us your favorite moments from Breaking Bad. And what we're going to do is this is kind of like an homage to the show. We're going to talk about our favorite moments throughout the seasons. And we'll bring up a topic, a moment that happened, and then we'll discuss it. And this literally can be from a particular death that happened or a moment of when a character changed.
Sparked something else. Right. The littlest tiny Easter egg that you saw that no one else did. You can talk about the fly that was buzzing around Gus's meth lab if you want. Christian, ask me if I'm ready to talk Breaking Bad.
Are you ready to talk Breaking Bad?
Look at this shirt, MF. This is a Ripped Apparel shirt, the same one that we gave RJ Mitty, not the same exact one because that'd be creepy. I ordered one that night, too, from RippedApparel.com.
That's right. Okay. So let's talk about some of the moments. Let's start with Mr. Mark Riley, who's sitting in and is going to tell a moment. Yodi, what do you have for us?
Do I have to do the voice when I do this?
No.
Just tell.
If you're on mic, you better be doing Yodi. Nobody wants anything from Riley.
Now, is there something in one of the moments, anything in particular in season one that sticks out that you remember?
You know, season one, the pilot.
Okay.
Continues to stick out for me because it set up everything, and for me, a lot of people were like, oh, season one took forever to start, and I get that, but it got me in the pilot because I love the start with the RV and his pants hanging out the window, and he he's getting his gun, and there's. You hear the sirens and you're like, what the hell is going on?
That's what locks you in right away.
It locked me in right away. Yeah. And because of Bryan Cranston being the actor that he is, at that moment, I just was hooked by his character without knowing a lot about it.
Right.
Just knowing the stakes of his character in the middle of this action was amazing for me, and that will always be my favorite episode of the season one.
Yeah, I feel like I cheated a little bit simply because, like we all did, because we didn't start watching it when the show debuted. And I think that the only argument I'll hear that the show starts a little slow is from people who had to go week to week to week, because if you see the pilot, again, it's like, what crazy misadventure did the dad from Malcolm in the Middle get into this week?
Right, yeah. Right.
But then once it goes into it, and I think that the finale of the whole show brought us back to that, is that when he's the chemistry teacher, and he says in maybe the, I think the first episode, when he says chemistry is the study of change,
so
you don't know that it's going to be him changing, that he's literally going to turn into this evil megalomaniacal bastard. But
you wanted to say megalodon.
You know what's funny though too, is, and you know
it was a big word.
You know, I was singing the same tune, by the way, with you as far as the evil. And when we get to the finale, my opinion of that has changed. Do I think he's done terrible, awful things? Absolutely.
Then you'd be right.
Do I think that a piece of his goodness survived? I absolutely do.
Mm.
And we'll talk about that, you know, when we get to the finale. But like, I that was the beauty of that speech that Mark just brought up, was fact that it was the change, the evolution. And Vince Gilligan is so smart that he knew, like he said over and over again, he wanted to take Mr. Chips and turn him into Scarface.
Yeah.
Tiffany, you just got into this series recently because RJ Mitty was on the thing and you did your homework, professional. And so what were your initial reactions of the first season, and what moment really struck you from the first season?
Well, because I literally watched seasons 1 through 5.5.
It was like one movie.
Like in 2 weekends. So what's the end of season one?
A lot of pizza ordered, a lot of Tuco.
It's when they're stuck with Tuco out in the That's two.
See, this is my problem.
Tuco is at the very end.
It shows you what a great show that Breaking Bad is, that it kind of all lumps together. Yeah. It's not like, you know, an episode of, like, even like 24, you know by the individual beats which season that was.
Well,
but with something like Breaking Bad,
actually, like, some of the names are repeated, I want to say.
Like,
I want to say that in season, like, I feel like I saw the title, the Ozymandias one.
Yeah.
Like, in another season? I could totally be making
but
that
isn't Ozymandias, isn't that the name of the, I think that's, wasn't that part of the...
That was the big third-to-last episode. So,
well, you guys are all fumbling around title episodes. So
that's right. Tuco killed off his partner at the very end.
Okay,
that was
so
from Dylan McKinnon.
I think the interaction, obviously, between Jesse and him was the biggest for me.
Yeah.
Where he, I think it's in the first season, where he's asking him to get all the stuff for the first time, and he's like, he just starts talking to him, and he's like, I can't even say this stuff. And you see what their relationship is going to be like at this point.
And the first time we meet Jesse Pinkman, when Walt decides to go on that ride along, just because he knows that he might be getting into something, that Hank may inevitably be the conduit to that, even though he doesn't know what's going on. Mm-hmm. And Jesse sneaking out the window, and who is this kind of punky kid who's just kind of jittery. And even going back and watching that, seeing what becomes of Jesse Pinkman, it's just amazing to watch the transformation of both of them, and to see Walter White, and maybe he didn't even think that far ahead, but the first time he sees Jesse since he was this kid failing his chemistry class, does he in his mind, because he's kind of thinking, if I need this kid, I can control him and kind of bend him to do my bidding. I don't
You're absolutely right.
Yeah, absolutely. I am winning this Breaking Bad conversation.
Well,
thus far.
I don't know. And I got that too, because, you know, it's like you
it's
wonder
not a competition.
Why.
It's not.
I think it's just a discussion.
You wonder why he doesn't, you know, go, hey, Hank, over there, the guy's running. No, he holds it in. He keeps it in. He had
that idea, and that's what we find out towards the end.
And Ellis, your point is right on, I think. I think he knew from his, you know, teaching Jesse in high school that he's like, you know, subconsciously maybe, I could probably, you know, make this guy do what I want to do.
Well, I
want
to think it shows you.
Riley, I want to bring McCougan in for a little bit.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
His name's Josh McCougan.
Josh McCougan.
The wild
You've
man.
Heard of him.
He's going to take Yodi's spot for a second, because we don't necessarily have to go in order from like just season one. It's any moments you want. I bring in a caller in from Schmoville right now, and we'll see any moment you want to talk about on Breaking Bad. We can jump around. You guys have seen the season, what that meant for the show. So, hey, you're in Schmoville. Who do we got?
Hey guys, Stuart from Hawaii.
Stuart, what's up, man? So, Stuart, what moment in Breaking Bad history, minus the finale, was one of your favorites, and what got you going?
Gotta
pick one.
I think in the first season where Walt killed, I forget his name, but it was in the very first season.
Crazy Eight. Crazy Eight.
Crazy Eight, yeah.
Yeah.
The first time. That's the first time I ever felt like so uncomfortable with a show.
Yeah.
But it stuck me in so deep that I had to watch it again the next week.
Great point. Thank you, Stuart. You know, and that's a good, great point, because that not only would it, and there's been a lot of these internet rumors too that, you know, Walt from season one, after someone died around him, he took on traits for their personality. Because if you notice, after he kills, because Crazy Eight always asked for the backs of his sandwiches to be cut off. Mm-hmm. And then Walt started doing that as well as the season.
So he's kind of like Shang Tsung. He kind of absorbed his soul.
He did it for all the deaths that happened. So that one really, a lot of people say, well, maybe that was the one that broke Walt bad. And I don't necessarily think so, because that was almost like a survival mode. Yeah, you have to go to a dark place, obviously, to fucking kill somebody. But
there's a moment in the show when he breaks bad.
And a particular moment that you think, yep, absolutely, and I want to see what you think, because Cranston has his
wild man opening cocky.
Yeah. I want to see so, what he thinks.
First of all, there is a really, really good article in GQ last month. Cranston's on the cover, and he talks about how, one, this show like changed him as a person.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Sure.
And he's a very conservative guy for the most part, and at the rap party, after they shot the last scene, it was just Cranston and like a minimal crew, right? They shut down the bar at the hotel where they're staying, and they've been staying all those years during the shooting of the show.
Yeah.
The head makeup artist is also a tattoo artist and comes in and starts tattooing everybody with Breaking Bad stuff.
Wow.
And Cranston got the Breaking Bad logo tiny, tiny on the inside of his middle finger. Oh, cool.
That's awesome.
So check that out. But for me, and check that out where?
GQ. The article. GQ. Okay.
For me...
anytime you're hanging out with Brian Cranston.
Right.
Whatever. which is a dream scenario. For me, every time I walk into a Home Depot, I think of this scene. Because he's fixing his house because he has all this money that he can spend now. He's never had. The water heater's broken.
Yeah.
And he sees that strung out dude going to make meth, and he tells him like how to actually make it.
Right. Yeah.
And then he goes into the parking lot and he's like, this is my territory. Right. That's the moment that Walt turned the switch and he was like, I'm going to be a badass. To me, in the show.
Yeah, I think as far as that goes, I can see that.
That's in season not one.
I think it's
that's
two.
Further
yeah,
in
it's
that.
Like
but
middle of season
even
two.
So, I still think it is still in two for me, but I think it's Jane. I think when he lets Jane die in front of him, there's a switch that has to happen there. You can still play badass and say, this is my territory, I'm the motherfucker, but to watch not only a woman die in front of you, but
the
your
way
partner,
he's standing,
your best friend, and a parent.
Yeah,
he's a parent
of a daughter.
Yes, he's watching. He's watching this. He's choosing to let this woman die to help himself and his business.
No,
yeah,
he's not to do it for Jesse.
Hold on,
he's not there to do it for Jesse.
He's doing it because this is a fight or flight moment.
No, it's
for
not.
Walt. Yes, it is. It is. Because
but,
this
yep,
what
I
she
agree
is
with
bad
you.
News. She's a drug addict. She's a junkie.
But that,
she will take him down because she's got loose lips and loose lips shink shit.
Whatever. I agree with you. But and a badass evil motherfucker says,
correct.
Time. That's my point.
Okay.
Is that that's the point? I agree that in what he was doing and for what Walter White had to do, that unfortunately had to be done for him. Otherwise, she would have caused a mess.
Correct.
It would have been Richie Aprile from The Sopranos.
Yep.
It would have been a mess.
But would she have? They were going to leave together.
Yeah, I think that she was bad news. If you're Walt and from an evil businessman in the meth business standpoint, it was the right move to just stand over her and let her die, because otherwise his whole enterprise probably could have gone under because of her. I want to spin it back, though, to something else. If you're talking about when was the seed planted in Walter, that became this evil thing that ultimately took him over. Mm-hmm. Remember when he's cooking in the first season, he cooks and then he comes back home and he lies to Skyler and he gets away with it, and they didn't really have much of a sex life right there, and then he just he's a bull in a china shop, and that china shop is named Skyler's undercarriage. He goes crazy on her. And
but you think that makes him evil?
No, but that's when he feels alive.
He's got the drug, right? 100%.
It's like you don't need to stop at 7-Eleven to get your horny goat weed if you go cook meth all day and you do something illegal and you just go home and give your wife the ride of her life. There was something in him that changed after that, and then ever since then, it's been there. So I think the sexual thing is not to be understated.
I agree. I want to take one call from Schmoville and get another moment from them and see what they're thinking about. We're talking Breaking Bad. We're talking seasons 1 through 5A. Hey, you're in Schmoville. Who do we got?
Hey, this is Nick from Chicago.
Nick from Chicago. What's up, my friend? So what moment in this Breaking Bad epic series would you like to talk about?
I got to say, right after he blows up Tuco's headquarters.
Fuck yeah.
And comes out of there and just goes off in his car. I thought that was the moment when he just felt that.
Yeah, and it's also where we are introduced to the name Heisenberg.
Mm-hmm.
It is that's where he comes up with Heisenberg. So that's an epic moment. Thank you so much. You'd appreciate the call.
Yeah, thanks for pointing that out, Nick. I'll see you at the Zanies in Chicago, October 17th through the 19th.
Make sure you see Big Ass Spider. This was awesome.
That scene when he blows up Tuco's kind of operation, the second floor, that was the first time when
the car's bouncing.
Yeah, and you're watching Cranston. You're like, okay, look, I understand how the guy's a genius chemist, and he can make this great meth, but how is he ever going to be an enforcer? Again, it's how is the dad, how is the dentist from Seinfeld going to be this badass drug enforcer?
Yeah. Dr. Tim Whatley.
How's that going to happen?
And the cool thing is he walks in scared. When you watch that, you can see he's nervous, and when he walks out, it's like
you have to be
different
scared.
Guy.
Yeah, because this thing went off, and he did it through his smarts, through being a chemist, and he got everybody's respect on the street.
Totally.
And that's just another part. It's like building this perfect beast.
It's what he used is that it was his brass balls, but it was how smart he was, mm-hmm. how much of a genius he was. And again, it showed. We forget that, you know, you use the whole gray matter element. This guy was... he was primed to be a multi-billionaire from the company that he created with these two dimwits.
Yeah.
And then, you know.
Great acting there at the end, by the way. Jesus H. Christ. They were brutal.
Wait, really?
Oh, finale. I don't talk about it
we're
yet.
We're not talking about the finale again. All right, we'll bring it. Okay, all right. I didn't mind.
Give me like two seconds.
Wow, my baby's blue.
With Big Ears and Stutters McGee.
All right. You got a problem with gray matter.
Hold on. Article's coming out tomorrow on Shmoza.com that I wrote called Why Breaking Bad Matters.
Oh, right? Very nice.
I get it. I get it. Gray matter? I get it.
And it really is. Okay, here's the thing. When you are perfect at something.
Thank you.
When you were almost perfect, right? Like me on a Friday night, right?
Yeah.
At 2 a.m. at a bar with just the loneliest girl hanging around.
Dance floor, Ella singing Panama into the karaoke.
Right.
Buffalo wings still fresh in the stomach. When you are trying in all facets of life, you are trying to be perfect, and you can't. It's impossible. Michael Jordan's life outside of basketball was horrendous, right? But he was perfect on a basketball
court. And that's what
Walt's the same way. He's perfect at cooking,
and he knows
everything else. He fucked up,
right?
Like when Mike says, "You screwed up a good thing, Walter." Yeah. You know, they had a good thing going, and Walt just got greedy.
Speaking of Mike, by the way, love the introduction of him because again, had Jane not gone the way, then we would have never had Mike. Because Mike comes in like the motherfucking cleaner. By the way, originally, Mike wasn't supposed to come in.
Well, and I remember when I was watching the show, I was like, we were talking about something, and I was like, that bodyguard guy did something, and you're like, he's not going to be the bodyguard for long. He's going to be Mike. And I was like, I'm not there yet. So I haven't got to know him enough yet.
What's the background on Mike?
The story was that originally, Saul Goodman was going to come in, do the cleanup, and take care of it and whatnot, make his call. But then they realized that they could turn this into a character, and then they brought in Jonathan Banks, who's the fantastic actor who wound up playing Mike. And then they got it. They turned Mike into this phenomenal character. Yep. That was the one thing for me. And again, obviously, everyone knows listening to this is a spoiler podcast, but when Walt kills Mike,
man,
that was the one time, I mean, not the one time, but the first time I called out at the TV and said, "Walt, you fucker." Like, that was when I was against Walter White when he killed Mike.
Well, this show never did anything to me like that because I thought everything played out so perfectly. Yeah. It developed at such a crisp pace until you get to season 5B when something happened that really upset me. But I thought even killing Mike, I thought it was the right thing to do at the time.
Right.
And what was really a ballsy decision, and I don't know if Gillian had this whole thing mapped out, like he had like a Lucasian kind of thing that I see this universe, but when Saul Goodman is introduced and it's played by the hysterical Bob Odenkirk, and I've been a huge fan of his, since before Mr. Show.
Mr. Show,
and to see him come in there, I don't know if you're watching that live, and maybe if one of our listeners can call in and just tell us if you were watching it week for week, when it came out, and he gets introduced, do you start to worry about where is the tone of the show going?
Yeah.
Because you have this hysterical comedian, but it works so well, the moments of levity that he provides. One of my favorite lines, and maybe my favorite line in the history of Breaking Bad, is when he's talking to Walt about something. He says, I once convinced the girl to sleep with me because I told her I was Kevin Costner. You know why? Because I believed I was Kevin Costner. It's so funny.
He had a ton of great lines.
And, so good.
Well, that was the brilliance of also what Breaking Bad had done throughout all the seasons, minus the last few for obvious reasons. It blended a good humor to it. It had a good humor, and it wasn't. And that's why I think that this Low Winter Sun isn't working, because there's no humor. It's just dark. The whole thing's just dark.
Well, and I think it's also like you bring characters in, and they're like with Saul. When he came in, he was funny and awkward a little bit, and you're like, is this going to work? And then it reminded me that we're in a small random town.
Yep.
Like if everyone was super polished and there was a polished lawyer there, no. If you're in middle America, small, in the middle of nowhere.
It's Albuquerque, New Mexico.
But like out in the middle, it's not like Los Angeles. Like you're not going to have a polished lawyer who's, you know. True. Dealing with the meth guys there.
Yeah, no, it was supposed to take place in Carson, California, is where it originally was supposed to take place.
Not a bad place. Yeah. I've done shows in Carson. Not a bad place for a meth show.
We're going to have Chris Stuckman call in a second. Before we do that, can we get JTI in the chair there a while, man?
Come on, JTI.
JTI is also a big Breaking Bad fan. We're going to hear.
Now introducing Joshua Anton.
Barbara Walters, thank you.
Barb.
Although, you know what? You should start saying, Wildman, you should start saying that is. Miss Piggy, by the way, because that sounds more like Miss Piggy.
I'm not going to do an impression.
Please don't.
Yeah, we have Jack Nicholson talking about Breaking Bad.
It's already a better Nicholson.
Yeah. Thank you.
Josh, I heard you did a.
All right, here we go. So let's do your favorite moment now, my friend. What moment of Breaking Bad, the first five seasons, was something that really impacted you?
I'm not going to really single down to an exact moment. But for me, one of my favorite seasons is season 4. And that's because that's really, for me, is a transition from Heisenberg became Heisenberg. And for me, it's that chess that chess game that he had with Gus in season 4 is amazing. And Jesse is the piece that they're playing with. Like, there's that point where Gus is like, okay, I can't get rid of him. Well, what if I get Jesse? And then he starts bringing him on with Mike.
Right.
He starts sending him out on missions, and he brings him back to New Mexico. And Jesse's like, one of my favorite episodes is when they go to Mexico, and they're like, Jesse, you're going to be our new meth guy. And Mike looks at him, and he's like, either we're all going home, or none of us are going home.
Right.
And Jesse's like, what the hell is going on?
All of that shit. Yeah. I mean, like, that's season 4. Look, I mean, the last 5A and 5B were great. Mm-hmm. I mean, fantastic, good wrap-ups and stuff. But season 4... I mean, that is a season that just, I mean, everything that went down with, I mean, because Gus was so terrifying. I mean, and he gets his.
The flashback?
Oh, my God.
Gus was so
especially now that now that you know the whole series, he really parallels Walter White.
Yeah,
so many different ways. Yeah. Like when he watches his partner die, that's the same way when Hank winds up eating it. That's exactly, when Walter sees it, he falls to the ground just like Gus did.
That wasn't planned either.
Well, that's not the finale.
Oh. I thought you meant second half. You're right.
So that's
it's hard for me to talk about Breaking Bad, like my favorite moments, and not involve all the action that happened with Gustavo Fring. And probably the 3 weeks of my life watching season 4 when I consumed more fast food chicken than any other time, because those Los Pollos, it made me so hungry for that shit, you know. And seeing Gus and the end of Gus's reign, you know, it ended in such a cool, dramatic way that actually transitions into something else I want to talk about with Breaking Bad, because we've been doing nothing but slurping Breaking Bad at this point, which is, justifiably so. But by the end of season 4, when Gus walks out and he looks like Harvey Dent, you know, because he's got the two-faced thing and explodes, that is something that Breaking Bad does not get away with in season 1. There is these moments in Breaking Bad where it was so great, and it kept building and building and building like a game of Jenga, to where now you could pull one piece and say, really, that happened? And I think it started with the airplanes crashing. That, to me, was the first time I was like, I'm going to have to suspend disbelief a little bit for this.
Yeah,
like, that seems like too many things, too many coincidences, getting lucky, but the show was good enough by that point.
Yeah, you're in. You're ready. All your cards are in. You're ready to watch.
Yeah.
And as you're watching that scene, because, absolutely, that's the most movie moment.
Really?
Of it.
The girls that happen to be an air traffic controller on duty.
Yeah, but those are the little coincidences that made Breaking Bad what they were.
It's like when your wife that you love farts in bed. Did she fart never in bed?
She's yes, never
she
done
did.
It. No, never done
yes,
it.
Yes, she does, Christian. She
did
does.
Once?
No, I just wanted to bring up one more thing I love about season four is I like what they do with Hank in that season. Because after
that
the
shootout,
yeah,
man,
the shootout, but not even that. The fact it's that twins. Like he lost he lost all drive to even go after mm-hmm. Heisenberg.
Yeah,
and there's that one dinner scene where he's like, you know, looks like this guy, you know, the, what was the guy that Gus originally had and Jesse shot at the end of season
Tuco.
Three. No,
oh, wait, which one?
The cook, the hippie cook.
Oh, Gabe.
Gabe.
Gail.
Yeah, Gail.
Oh,
there's
yeah,
that great scene.
John Leaho.
There's that great scene where Gail is pretty much, Hank is like, Gail was the main guy. And Heisenberg's at the dinner table, and he can't let it go. He's like, I don't know, maybe he wasn't. And
he has
that
a couple
scene.
Glasses of wine.
Yeah.
It's because
that
any time Walt got himself is in trouble, he was bombed. All right, let's take another call from Schmobile here to talk about their favorite thoughts. Hey, you're in Schmobile. Who do we got?
Hey guys, it's Alex.
Alex, what's up, dude? So what moment out of the Breaking Bad series did really stick out to you?
All right. Jesse was always like my favorite character. Nice. I always thought he was perhaps the most redeemable out of them all.
Even more than Walter Jr.?
And I think...
Walt Jr. Didn't have to be redeemed.
True, true.
Stuff.
Okay.
He never did anything.
Right. True. Okay.
And like I think one of my favorite scenes ever was... We all talked about how like Jane and like all these moments changed to Walter.
Yeah.
And I think, and it was probably one of the most scenes where I was on the edge of my seat the entire time was the season three finale when Walter has it done to his face with Mike and he tells Mike Gale's address. And at the same time, Gale's begging Jesse not to kill him and Jesse's just crying the whole time.
Yeah. I mean, it did. It showed that Jesse does, as fucked up as he was and as much of a criminal as he was, he had a conscience. Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally.
Yeah, I love Jesse, and Aaron Paul has become one of my favorite actors just from Breaking Bad.
Yeah, he's a great actor. Thanks for the call, Alex. Appreciate it.
That father son thing that I always wanted to happen, and the show did a perfect job of doing this because I just wanted one episode where Walt and Jesse really connect. And they become buddies. They become those guys that can have this great cook and then go out and have a beer after work. I always wanted to see that. And there's moments in when they're cooking at Gus's lab when everything's just going perfectly and they're high-fiving and it's a great cook. And then, hey, we're done. What are you doing this weekend? It never quite became pretty. It's like there's always some little fly in the ointment as, you know, the fly episode. So, well, you know, gives us an example of that. But it never quite got there. And that's... perfect design by Vince Gilligan.
And I think that they could never have that. Otherwise, it couldn't have got to the point where it did get to. Because they were never there. And even if I think when you look back at Walt, the moment where things change is when he like sees Jesse go out the window and doesn't say anything because he's like, normal person wouldn't be like, I'm not going to turn that kid in because he's going to make meth with me. Like, that way? Well, and so we always had to keep him in that, like,
I
just
totally
close
agree
enough,
with you.
But not too close.
Now, one of our loyal members of Schmobile here, at Myers FTW, writes in, Hank's character development was amazing. And out of all the characters, I think that Hank really had a strong, strong character development because when he was originally written, he was just written for comic development.
That damn
Hank?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really? Yeah.
Tyler
for
Myers
comedy?
Beat me to the punch.
Watch the first episode. The first episode, he's just like the beer drinking, cracking joke, like the macho.
I don't know that that's
guy.
The only reason he was written, but
this is from Vince Gilligan and Dean Norris.
Well, wasn't Jesse supposed to get killed off early too?
Yeah, first season.
But, and you think that when you're watching the pilot episode, you're like, oh yeah, it's this guy is gonna be kind of like, but you also know he's a DH in the whole time. So you know that something is going to break with this, you know, no pun intended, that their relationship is going to get really interesting really quick.
Yeah.
And what Dean Norris was able to do, there's two things in particular about his character that I love, is the first time he drives Walt Jr., because he thinks that Walt Jr. got caught with, like, pot or something.
Right.
And he drives him to Wendy's the hotel.
Yeah.
And he's just kind of giving him that talk, and it's just like your cool uncle, but also your hard-ass uncle at the same time. And at that point, I was like, there's no other actor I want than this Dean Norris guy who I'd never heard of before the show.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I thought you knew him beforehand. Okay. I thought you knew him. I don't know why.
No. I mean, we're buddies now. We hang out.
Fair enough. No, but you know, what they did with Hank was just, he literally, he became not only this guy, a likable guy, he became this badass motherfucker that you're watching him and you're just like, this guy is like, he is brilliant with the regard, with one, the one guy he wasn't brilliant with was his right under his nose, his brother-in-law. What do you got, JTI,
yeah,
before we got our guest with us?
I think for Hank, a big turning point for his character for me was the turtle. You want to talk about a badass scene?
Oh, right.
The turtle scene with the head. Before that, he was just a badass cop who was doing everything right.
Broke down.
Yeah, and he just, after that, he couldn't handle it.
Yeah. All right. So, guys, now joining us is a good buddy of ours. He has been on the podcast live. He has been in reviews with us. He is our fellow YouTube movie reviewer, Chris Stuckman, who has just got into the Breaking Bad series. Chris, how are you, man?
I'm doing great. How are you guys doing?
Good to have you back on the show, my friend.
We're good. Hey, Chris, what's cooking? Get it?
Very nice. Yeah. Very nice.
So
he's
clever.
Not the stand-up comedian.
You are definitely a professional comedian, Mark.
That's right. Chris, all right. So you are balls deep into this series at this point.
A really gross, like, chain of events that just happened.
I thought that was
wait. Tiffany, that was comic timing. Wait, Tiffany, can you repeat why?
Because you
what
just said
say?
Something inappropriate, and
I
then
say?
A burp came after it.
What did I say?
Can we please not fight when Chris Stuckman is on the phone?
Tiffany, I want to know what I said. I sometimes I don't remember.
Chris, you got into Breaking Bad. When exactly did you binge watch, like Tiffany Smith over here did?
I did. About a month ago, I got on Netflix. I watched like season 1 through season 5A in about 3 weeks. So yeah, it was addictive. The first season was good. You know, like a lot of people told me, sometime around the second season, you'll probably get hooked. Yeah. I honestly was hooked after the pilot, and I was like, yeah, this is a good show. But then it was right around like season 2, the midway point of season 2, where I was like, holy shit, this show's incredible.
That's what it is. We've described this, again, when we had Walt Jr. on the show, we were saying how when you get into season 1, like you said, you watch, you go, yeah, that was good. I definitely see where the writing's good. 2, you go, okay, we're in for something special. 3, you're like, wow. 4 is holy shit. And by the end of 5, you're just like, ah, best show I've ever seen in my life.
Except maybe The Wire. It gets into your veins in a way that TV shows normally don't do. Chris, do any moments in the early, maybe seasons 1 or 2, stick with you as that time when it really got its hooks into you?
Yeah, in season 1, for sure, the moment where I was like, okay, I'm in for something good, is where Walt goes into Tuco's office with those chemicals in the bag.
Yeah.
And, you know, he just explodes the place, and he's like, you're crazy, and he holds up the restroom. He's like, you want to find out what I can do? And I was like, dude, this guy's awesome. That's the first time he says
Heisenberg,
and it's that first little taste of him becoming less of a man than he was before, you know, and I just, that's when it really started to really get me, because I was able to realize like the direction the show was going in was you're going to be able to watch this character just go down this path of events, and you get to kind of subtly watch a guy turn into a villain, and it's really cool how you care about him at the same time. And so I think that's like the first moment where I was like, yes, that's the moment right there.
Well, like Vince Gilligan said though too, it's that Mr. Chips turns into Scarface, and it happens in such a brilliant way. Now, someone we haven't talked about yet on the show that we have to get into and talk about is Todd. Can we play the song again, Johnny, for what we introed the beginning of the program with? The very before we
this
went on.
This song is so many people's ringtones now.
Lydia. She was the most glorious creature.
It's everything about this song. Like when it starts, when he's walking, I know we're going to, but it's this.
Dice! Dubetti! Gobble! The Marx Brothers.
There we go. One. And then Walt is doing his thing, and.
Lydia, oh Lydia, say, have you met Lydia?
It's just so fucking creepy to have, for so many reasons.
Now, I want to serve it up to Chris first because he's calling in.
Yeah.
Chris, when that moment happened with Todd, when you realize that he's not just this happy-go-lucky Matt Damon wannabe, when he caps that poor bastard on the dirt bike, did that just shock the hell out of you, or were you kind of suspecting something already?
I wasn't suspecting something. I was wondering what they were going to do with the kid since the episode introed with him. But I don't really call him Todd. I refer to him as Satan.
Yeah, right?
He's got the red hair to prove it.
Yeah.
He seriously is... In that entire show, the character that I despise the most, because
he's terrifying.
There were amazing villains in that show, like Gus Fring was so cool, but you actually kind of cared about him slightly because you saw his past and that horrible thing that happened to him. But this guy, Todd, he's just a fucker. Nothing about him, he's just terrible, and that's one of the reasons I love the the moment in the finale with Jesse Pinkman and him, because that just gave me so much pleasure to watch that happen.
Stand up and cheer.
It absolutely did. And because you know what it is about Todd is because, look, there are many maniacal characters like Tuco throughout the show, but the thing with Todd is Todd was killing for a reason. He just had no emotion behind it. And even in that, when another great moment, when Walt sets up that whole videotape when he frames Hank, which is an amazing moment with him and Marie, and then to get him back and all that stuff, then Hank gets Jesse, and Jesse does the whole confessional tape. When when Jack's playing back that tape, and he mentions Todd.
Yeah.
And Todd, he smiles.
Yeah. He's like, they said my name on I got my name in the paper. I hit a home run and people talked about me.
Well, and I went into it seeing him because I watched Friday Night Lights. So I had this like positive vibe about him as soon as I saw him on the screen. And I was like, no, I don't want him to be like, he's so sweet on Friday Night Lights.
Not anymore. He's so good
in
it.
And so when you see him do stuff, there was dead eyes.
Yeah,
like when he did stuff, you were like, "Is he thinking about this, or is he just like acting?"
And which the actor exactly with the dirt bike. Jesse Plemons was also in Battleship. If Todd was in Battleship, that whole movie would have been over in like 20 minutes.
It's
goodbye, Alien.
It's hysterical because we talked to him on the red carpet, and at the time we're like, "Ah, I don't know, this guy seems like he doesn't give a shit." We're like, "No, he's probably trying to kill us at this point." But Chris, so what other parts in say, because we're not talking about the finale just yet. We're gonna get that gonna get into that in just a second, but what other moments, say, whether it be in season 5 or 4, 3, 2, 1, what moments really stood out to you? And if we covered them already, I'll let you know.
One of the things I loved about the show was how funny it can be. Like, it wasn't just this straight drama. It actually had some pretty hilarious moments leading up to it. And
which moment
in
particular?
A lot of the best ones for me were the chemistry between Aaron Paul and Bryan Cranston.
Absolutely.
Like, when they were getting to know each other. And one of their first big cooks in the RV, Walt is trying to explain how he's about to use copper to conduct this current. And he's like, do you know what elements we're going to be using to conduct this current? And Jesse's like, a wire.
Yeah.
There's just like so many great moments in that show like that, that really, it's not just like a hilarious, it's a very funny show, but it's not just like this serious thing that's going to make you depressed. It actually has a really good dark comic stuff
for sure,
really,
and it did from season 1 on,
and that's how the show was pitched, at least the way I think a lot of the public got drawn into the show was it's like, hey, what happens when these two oddballs decide to start making meth together,
right?
And then it just became this whole other thing, this phenomenon. But initially it's like, it's kind of like the Odd Couple.
You knew you
with
had
hard
to,
drugs,
because when you sell that show, first of all, and they've said this, it is almost impossible to sell that type of show to any network. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter what the hell it is. It could be AMC, it could be HBO. What are you two characters? Are you flirting over there? What's going on?
Yes.
All right. So what you can do?
Notes.
Yeah, but the fact is that they got the show on. You have to throw that humor in there, and then once you start to hook people, you really get, you know, you really get the, what the hell's going on?
Nothing.
Why are you fucking dancing? Get out of here.
What?
Get out of here. You're out. Yeah.
Fuck off.
You're out into the finale. You don't come back. You're
Dude,
out.
There's fucking 15 minutes left. I'm fucking sticking around.
They fucking take the earphones off. Get out of here.
So many
there
has
been
dancing
an,
like
there's
an asshole
an epidemic
face.
Of note passing and gum chewing in this
crowd.
We
got our guest for like 2 fucking minutes, and this guy's playing with his ball bag, dancing like a gypsy.
I wasn't touching shit.
Get out of here!
All right. Chris, stand by. We were having some technical difficulties.
It's called Wild Man Dildo
problem.
Face.
Chris met Macuga. He knows
what
an animal that guy is.
That's right. Okay. So
it's funny. I'm not watching on video, but I knew you were yelling at Josh Macuga.
Now, you know, speaking of humor, Chris, how do you feel about Badger and Skinny Pete?
You know, the first few episodes, I was like, oh, God, I cannot stand this guy's voice. It's just like he has this voice like, hey, Jesse, it's Nick's and that. And it's, I don't know. It's just, I didn't really like him at first. But after a while, once you got to get to know his character a little bit more and he came around, it was I was fine with him. Skinny Pete, this is going to sound weird, but I used to know a guy exactly like him.
Wow.
Like, exactly like him. The mannerisms, the look, and everything. And so I kind of gravitated towards his character because of that. But I think that's one of the pluses of the show is that they have a good way of introducing characters that are sort of comic relief.
But real.
Kind of like, you know, like Saul.
Yeah.
And at first you could be like, wow, this character could just annoy the shit out of me. But then you really start to like him because I don't even, like, I'm actually excited for a spinoff show for once. And that's something I'm never into.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do we think that spinoff show is going to affect the lineage of Breaking Bad? No, or do we think it's
a prequel?
It's a prequel. I know it's a prequel, but it's like, again, it's associated with Breaking Bad. And is there going to be a moment when he sees Bryan Cranston in line, you know, at another car wash or something like that? Do we think that's going to affect the greatness that was Breaking Bad?
I don't know. I mean, it just depends on what Vince Gilligan. At this point, you know, it's the same thing you say with Nolan. It's like, in Gilligan, we trust at this point until he lets us down.
Did you have lunch with Vince Gilligan this week? You're quoting the guy an awful lot.
Look, I'm obsessed with this fucking show, okay? I'm
obsessed with everything. How involved is Gilligan with the
spin-off? Did you grow up watching The X-Files, Christian?
No, I've watched parts of it. I've seen the Cranston episode. I've seen some
Was he involved in The X-Files, probably?
Yeah, he was one of the main writers, yeah.
Okay, Vince Gilligan was one of the producers of The X-Files. He wrote and many of the best episodes. That's how literally half the cast of Breaking Bad is because of X-Files. Dean Norris is on X-Files.
Oh,
Aaron
cool.
Paul is on X-Files. Yeah. Bryan Cranston was on X-Files.
And that's how he was able to, because he remembered Bryan Cranston from that episode he was on and knew that Bryan Cranston could fit that role, and that's why he wrote it for Bryan Cranston.
Ah, okay. Yeah, I mean, I was a huge fan of the X-Files. I just knew Chris Carter.
All right, now we got to talk about this finale for a second, but before I, you know, I have to, we got to let Chris go here in a second, but I want to get one more moment before we get into the finale. Chris, can you give us one more moment of the series? Or actually, you know what? Right before we get into the finale here,
something that teased us with maybe season four that really stuck with you.
No, maybe even five. I'm just saying because we're going to the finale here, so maybe five. Like, what happened in this season that just happened? Not the finale. What happened in this season that really gotcha. Oh shit. You there?
Oh man. How?
Oh shit.
How dare you ask a question like that? That is that specific. You put that many parameters on him, and then you hang up on the poor kid. You set him up perfectly, and then you just pull the plug like Walter White watching that poor girl die.
Oh, wait, no. I think he's still here. Chris, you still there?
No, he's not.
Oh, and now you're
just Chris, were you there?
Hello?
Yeah, are you there?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, Chris. Go ahead. I thought I lost you. Go ahead and say your moment. I miss you.
Not just because that episode is directed so well, and not just because it was like, oh, all these big story arcs are finally coming to a close. It was actually, I don't know, like every scene was incredible. And Hank's character through season 5A and B became so riveting for me, like that moment at the end of B where he like looks up on the toilet and then he took a shit for a year because the show didn't come back for a year,
right?
But like that, his character really owned season 5 for me. Like Bryan Cranston, you know, he's incredible, but the character of Hank up until like 4 and 5 onward, he really went away from just being this funny comic relief guy to being this incredible badass. And I heard you guys talking about that before I called in, but definitely that episode that Ryan Johnson directed.
Oh, Ryan Johnson.
Hyperventilating when he was driving the car.
So good.
Oh my God.
Yeah. So good.
And I got really excited too when he went, you didn't know if Hank was going to be back after he got shot and if he still had it with him. And then when he's proving, he's like, then why are Gus Fring's fingerprints in Gail Bettinger's apartment? That just, the way he delivered that line was maybe one of the best cliffhangers the show or any show has ever produced.
So good. All right, Chris, very glad that you finally got into the show, my friend. Glad that you called in. Look forward to having you back on the show soon. Thank you very much. Check out Chris Stuckman at Chris_Stuckman with two N's and his YouTube channel, youtube.com/Chris Stuckman.
Thanks, guys. Have a good night.
All right, dude.
Look forward to cooking with Chris in Cleveland later this year.
All right, we have a couple minutes here. Let's talk about this finale.
Now I want to put this out there, is that we don't have a lot of time, so we can't just go scene by scene by scene. I know you and Vince Gilligan are personal
buddies.
You're going to have to talk about a few of the highlights of season 5. One of my favorite ones right off the bat is the Mr. Megorium's Wonder Emporium line, where it seems like the most trivial thing that they just throw away. It's like, why am I in this cave?
There's
two copies, and yet I was doing some research online, and Mr. Megorium's Wonder Emporium, there's a line in there where they're referencing Shakespeare, and it just fits so perfectly. There's a thing that Mr. Megorium says in that movie, and it references, it kind of gives you a hint as to how Walt's gonna go, and it's like they wasted nothing.
And they did that, and they did it earlier in the season too when they're watching Scarface, you know, where even where Walter Jr. is like, everybody's gonna die.
Yeah, but I mean, come on, Mr. Megorium's Wonder Poem is like an all-time classic in film. So
absolutely, look, everything is, I know not that movie itself, but I mean, but no, but where are you going with the Shakespeare though? As far as like everything, the moments that they set up, but what they did with Scarface again with the gun, and they go back back. And the thing is, the way he set it up, and Walt had to do it his way. So he runs into the two cartoon characters, apparently, that the Wild Man had a problem with in the beginning there. Like, how great was the scene?
The scene was incredible.
Okay, so what was the problem? Wrong. Real quick, what was the problem with the acting?
I just, you know...
I didn't think it was a problem.
What are you doing?
Out of their mind. This fucking you don't, bearded weirdo. Ken Napsok staring at them from the side.
Come on.
It looks like Ken Napsok. Look at him. Pit boss is just depressed back there. Instead of words. It's just hour like, and a half.
I don't know. It's like textbook. This is how you don't act. You don't stutter.
I thought they were good, and I think.
Yeah. But that scene. Here's the thing. Yeah, that scene amazing. Was the smartest scene in the show.
So with those with the lasers with Skinny Pete yeah. and the Badger and the whole set. And by the way, right before the episode beforehand, I watched that end scene like 1,000 times. The Charlie uh-huh. Rose scene, because that scene. Really catapulted because we thought because he's on the phone with Walt Jr. He's given up because Walt Jr. wants nothing to do with him, and then it's over. He's sitting there, he's okay, let the cops come get me, and Heisenberg retires, or Heisenberg is dead, so we think, and then Charlie Rose, that whole thing, and then this the catalyst of what ultimately turned him into Walter Heisenberg in the first place mm-hmm. and got him into the meth thing because of this whole thing with gray matter. It's on. Yeah. He's back. He gets and propels us into motion for the finale.
Yeah, and I love when things are really cocky, when art is so cocky that it knows it's got you by the balls. It's like a great rock band that just comes on stage and just rips into their first song. When you see that empty glass of whiskey or whatever the hell he was yeah. drinking, and it launches into the Breaking Bad theme, that's the show saying, wait until you see how we end this show. We're not going to half-ass this. We're not going to play Journey and then suddenly turn the TV off. We are going to own you yeah. through the end of this show, right. And they ended up living up to that promise, I thought.
All right, so you got something to say, JT?
Yeah, I just want to say, before that scene, you know, I love the laser scene where he puts his hand down, lasers came on. The scene in the car for me, the opening shot, and he's in there, and in the cop car, he sees the lights mm-hmm. through the snow.
Just get me home.
He's
just
like,
get me home.
Just get me home. And the keys fall down, mm-hmm. and it's like it's almost like he thinks he's supposed to be doing this.
Yeah, I love that scene. All of that, and because it's just he had to go out his own way on his own terms, and he sets everything up. And that scene, real quick, again, because I only have a little bit of time left, but there's a great moment in The Sopranos. Again, I know this show has been compared to The Sopranos so many times. There's a great scene between Carmella and Tony in the house where they're getting through this big, huge fight, and it's this end. And Edie Falco won the award for it. Yeah. There's a scene between Skyler and Walt in this kitchen here where he shows up and he just, and that moment of, because he literally says, the reason I did this was for, and she cuts him off, and because I was thinking the same thing. I'm like, if this fucking guy says it one more time, and she goes, if you say it one more time, I'm like, nice, Skyler. And he goes, I did it for me. I liked it. Yeah. I was like, oh, this show is so good.
Yeah. The hard part for me, and I've watched the finale 3 times now. Yeah. I'm a nerd like that.
Yeah.
I like it chokes me up to watch a father watch his son at the lowest
through the window
possible moment through a window, his crippled son, his shattered life in one shot through a shitty window in a bad neighborhood.
Yeah.
And a public school bus after he bought him that awesome car, the public school bus drops him. I mean, it's the saddest thing in the world.
Josh, you're going to be a great father. Yeah, you're going to be a great father.
I am a great father, Mark.
Yeah. But he knows what he has to do. Yeah. He knows it's the last time he's going to see any of his family. He pets his daughter. He pets her, strokes his hair, basically knows it's the only family contact he's getting is from his daughter, and he goes and he leaves, and then it's the setup. We already saw him set up the gun, and then the whole thing with Jack, and this thing with the way he sets up the alarm, and like we said in our review, was a little convenient that, you know, right before, who cares?
By that point, didn't matter. He gets to look at Jesse Pinkman in the eye one more time. Jesse Pinkman rides off into Need for Speed.
Yeah.
And then Bryan Cranston
But the gun, you gotta talk about the gun. When the gun pops up and he wipes everybody out like
I'm running the 2-minute offense I'm trying to throw quick outs here.
The very end. And get Johnny Ice the mic here because I know that he's got a little theory about what happens here. So, all right. So, at the very end, Walter White walks in with his baby. The meth that he created.
Yeah, he's touching some of his favorite instruments, and he's looking at stuff.
And he craps out.
He just kind of slips, and he falls. And is he dead? No. Yeah, he's dead. He dies.
Now, Johnny Ice has a moronic. Johnny Ice is moronic.
Well, it's not. I don't think it's moronic.
It's moronic.
Television. Anything can help in television.
But I'll tell you why it's moronic. I'll tell you why it's moronic after you say it. No, I want to hear you say it first.
Okay. So, I mean, at the end, they're doing the pull-out shot where it's, like, wrapping around, and his eyes aren't closed. He didn't have a gunshot wound that was fatal. I mean, yeah, he had cancer, but he didn't have that gunshot wound that was fatal. It was, like,
fucking
to the lower right.
Bled to death,
never
man.
Really. You don't know. Cops were already there. They could have had an ambulance there within, like, 10 minutes.
There was
gunshots and everything.
Here's a reason why
somebody called that in.
But there's two reasons why I think he's dead. One, because Vince Gilligan said
told
he's dead.
You when you were at lunch.
Yes. He said, pass the fucking salt, Walt's dead.
Yeah.
And then Bryan Cranston said that's the way he had to go out, dead on his own terms.
But
so he's fucking
what's
dead.
What's the bigger twist for Breaking Bad than to convince everybody that Walt's dead and have him show
let's,
up?
Let's on, walk away right, from right, the right, table.
That's,
right, we're up.
That's it. Schmoville. So here's the final thought here.
Television.
Final thought here. At Schmoes, no. Tweet in, do you think Walt could have survived and tell Johnny Icebox he's
never
nuts?
Closed his eyes. You couldn't tell he was right, dead. Well, he could have just been laying there.
Johnny, I've been to a lot of parties, and I know when they play Badfinger, that means the party's over.
We got 3 minutes.
Baby blue. Yeah.
All right. So what do we got? So that's our Breaking Bad podcast. I'd like to thank Clare Kramer for coming in today, Iliza Shelsinger, the whole podcast crew. Mark, what do we have coming up in the next few weeks?
Well, next week I will be out of town. Please come see me at the DC Improv. I have like 9 family members, including my grandma, coming to see me live. So I need the support of Schmoville to pack that audience and make them laugh at the DC Improv. Tiffany, weirdly, we'll also be out of town. It's
Whoa,
the same.
Again.
Maybe.
I'm going to be in New York for Comic-Con.
We're going to go to the Bahamas, the Sandals Resort that we stayed at. However, we are not going to leave Schmoville empty-handed. Co-hosting for me in my stead next week is going to be the guy who just crushed it in his Schmoes No Review debut, Mr. Mark Riley.
Yodi,
he saw Gravity.
Yodi
gave a passable impression of Mark L, so I'm going to let
that's
him
good.
Co-host
like
for here on the podcast.
Okay.
But that's not all.
What do we got?
That's not all. While you were out dining with Vince Gilligan at Spago,
yeah.
I had a little rendezvous of my own. I met up with a female friend of ours, another hot blonde. Her name is Bonnie Somerville. Bonnie Somerville will be coming back
That's
to Schmoville
fine.
Next week to settle the score with Christian Harloff, and in her corner will be some sort of audio-visual paraphernalia.
I got a text from her, by the way. Gave the video to Ellis, so that's all I know.
Some
but,
sort of Betamax thing.
And, great. So Bonnie's coming back next week, and I'll make sure that she's calm. And then we have Bonnie, we have Mark Riley. And again, guys, Schmoville, you guys have been doing reviews of the podcast. They have been phenomenal. Again, in five weeks from now, we're going to pick one of you guys, and you will host a segment on the show. It's going to be a lot of fun. So make sure you review this episode of the podcast. What did you think? It was a pleasure talking Breaking Bad. Tiffany Smith, Mark
Ellis.
We
didn't even talk ricin. That was
I know. It's
good.
Too much. It's good talk
that
about
ricin,
this.
Once it gets in your veins, man, that is
you
some
die.
Good shit. Yeah.
Peace out, mother Fs.
You're listening to the Toad Hop Network, radio worth watching.